Priya Biju can speak up. Hi Priya.
Hi, hi. You're speaking to Priya Mohan?
No, Priya Biju.
Oh, okay.
I think the surname is so important now.
Yeah.
Plenty with exactly. The same first name.
So yeah. Your cards will be shown by timer 2 or timer 1?
All the color, yeah, color will be shown by timer 1.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm here. Good to go.
अभी वो जरा घंटी ऑफ कर देता हूँ बता
Jisha and Ananda.
Yes, ma'am.
In another 2 minutes, you can start the
okay
video, right?
Yes.
Tommy, in speaker view, timer 2 is visible. Timer 1, you have to shift one more. So can the timer 1...
Robin, when the debate starts, the timer 1 will be spotlighted.
Okay, fine. Fair enough.
Our timer 2 will be timing the role players, and that's why the timer 2 is probably spotlighted now. But then for the debate, the timer 1 will be spotlighted.
Fair enough.
Sergeant at Arms, raise, you're ready.
Yes, Diten Somia, I'm ready.
Okay, so as soon as the video stops, please take over. We'll start bank at 8 o'clock, yeah?
Yes.
Can you switch on your...
Raise, can you please switch on your video?
Yeah, it is on, okay.
Jisha, you can start the music.
Thank you.
A very good morning and a warm welcome to all Toastmasters and guests to the District 105 Interdivision Debate Contest for the year 2020-2021. Francis Scott Fitzgerald once said, "The test of a first-rate intelligence is the ability to hold two opposed ideas in mind at the same time and still retain the ability to function. Debate tests and builds that ability by forcing people to see both sides of issues." I would like to begin by stating the Toastmasters International mission. We empower individuals to become effective communicators and leaders. Some golden rules to be respected during an online contest. All attendees are requested to keep all noise-making devices, including your partners, on mute. Speakers are requested to refrain from talking on the three topics: sex, politics, and religion, which are a taboo in this region. All attendees must mute their audio and keep their videos switched off at all times, unless instructed otherwise by the moderators. The chat function will be closed until the contest is over for a successful contest. However, you can use the reaction buttons generously to show your appreciation. During the debate, all eight contestants, two timers, and moderator are requested to keep their videos on until the end of that particular debate segment. Once the moderator starts the debate, this virtual meeting room will be locked. You will be allowed in only when the Zoom master lets you in. Please note that this online meeting is being recorded. Best wishes to everyone. Now, I would like to hand over the screen to the dedicated and dynamic Interdivision Debate Contest Chairperson, Distinguished Toastmaster Soumya Rangarajan. Distinguished Toastmaster Soumya has been busy exploring her editing skills this year, and she is the chief editor, the driving force behind the 14 newsletters released by District 105 Public Relations Newsletter Team. So, please help me welcome her with a huge round of applause. The screen is yours, madam.
Thank you so much, Toastmaster Reyes. Good morning, distinguished leaders, adjudicators, soldiers, and spectators. Welcome to the friendliest and safest war zone to witness a planned annual battle between friends who temporarily turned into foes. Now, don't be misled by the term safest and friendliest, because while the armies may not be hostile, combat is going to be fierce, because our 14 commanders, the 14 division directors, have handpicked their best warriors. Now, these warriors have in their arsenal missiles of wit, wisdom, logic, powered by facts, research, and the ability to convince. But ammunition notwithstanding, these dignified fighters will maintain the basic values of respect and integrity at all times. So welcome, friends, to the Interdivision Debate Contest 2021 of District 105. Capitalizing on the opportunities that the virtual medium has thrown open, an interdivision debate was organized for the very first time last year in 2020. This year, the contest has shifted to a higher plane because the combatants were enlisted much sooner and rigorous training started months ago. So today we will be witnessing the preliminary rounds comprising of seven debates. The winners of each debate and the losing team with the highest score will proceed to the quarterfinals to be held tomorrow. The topics for all the rounds except the finals have been declared to the teams. I take this opportunity to thank DTM Gurbindarpur for giving me the opportunity to organize this event. To move forward, I now invite a Toastmaster, who has been in this fraternity since the last 3 years as a member of JSS Toastmasters Club. This dedicated teacher who's imparting knowledge and grooming youngsters is a keen learner who believes that one must remain a student throughout life. So ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together to welcome our host for today, Toastmaster Jyoti Kaur.
Thank you, DTM Soumya. Vernon Howard once said, and I quote, "Always walk through life as if you have something new to learn, and you will." A very excellent good morning to the ladies and gentlemen, dignitaries in the house, and fellow Toastmasters. I, Jyoti, your master of ceremony, would like to take the privilege of welcoming you all to the District 105 Interdivision Debate Contest 2020-2021. How many of you know how to ride a cycle? I'm sure almost all of us must have ridden a bicycle in our lives. Riding a bicycle on an accelerated plane leaves us exhausted, famished, downhearted, and wrathful at times. While riding up the hill, we need to put an extra chunk of energy in order to conquer the difficult path. And in the course, one might feel like giving up at any time. The sojourn seems tough and impossible at times, but this is the juncture where we need to persevere diligently and reach the top of the hill. This is exactly what defines our lives. There are tough times when we need to pedal harder to reach the top of the hill. The cycle teaches us to be gritty and never to give up. Life is all about learning to balance in the cycle of life. Moments when riding can be a breeze, then there are those moments who require us to put in more efforts. However, as long as we maintain the right balance, we will still be astride a cycle of life. How does one maintain the right balance is the key question. The ability to make an educated decision after knowing all aspects of an issue goes a long way in striking equilibrium in life. Whether it be riding a cycle or having a discussion, we have to ensure both sides are given equal weightage. This is exactly how debates function. Both sides of a debate present their facts, logic, and rationale, and empower us to make the right choice. Let us imbibe this takeaway and analyze what can we learn today from this debate. I think a Friday morning with an insightful debate is the choice of the wise, as we get to witness the various facets of persuasion, passion, and presence of mind. Our lives are punctuated with events, thoughts, experiences, and debates of different tastes. Debates imparts us the message that there's always another way to see the world, and that adds to a plethora of wisdom. It is essential to step into someone else's shoes to understand the other's perspective, which is exactly what our debaters are about to do. It is time for the showdown to begin. So relax. With the perfect aura set to witness a debate, let me welcome the most important person to set the ball rolling. She loves reading and writing. She's a legal member of Discovery Gardens Toastmaster Club since 2017. The most interesting part that tallies with me is that she's a teacher by profession. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Toastmaster Priya Biju with a thundering round of applause, the debate moderator for this segment. Toastmaster Priya, the virtual stage is yours.
Thank you, MC Jyoti. Good morning, dignitaries in the house, Toastmasters and guests. Welcome to the preliminary rounds of the District 105 Inter-Division Debate Contest, and it is my pleasure to be the debate moderator for the first four rounds of the contest. Debate is a process which involves formal disclosure on a particular topic wherein the arguments are put forward from the two opposing viewpoints. Logical consistency, factual accuracy, and an element of emotional appeal are the major elements of a good debate. Debating in various forms has been visible long back in the history and can be traced back to the philosophical and political debates of ancient Greece, as in the Athenian democracy, and the Shastra-Ratha in the ancient Indian democracy. In various places, from coffee houses, debate halls, and the legislative assemblies, we have been watching debates, and now on this virtual platforms. So let us be ready to witness the clash of the titans, where the verbal warriors have honed their skills to battle it out with the strongest weapon ever existed, words. Let us brace ourselves to see the fighters in action. Let us now begin the battle. The Inter-Division Debate Contest 2020-21. At the outset, let me state the debate rules. The rules are, if a team does not report to the commencement of the contest, a walkover will be provided to the opposition team present, and they automatically move to the next round. If both the teams in the group are not present, at the time of the commencement, the group shall be eliminated from participation. No speaker shall take the opportunity of abusing or accusing the opponent speaker at any point of time. In case of technical failure, the chief judge will intervene and stop the speaker. 1 minute shall be given for the participant to reconnect. The speaker shall continue from where they ended the speech and at the time of the technical failure. The speaker will be given the remaining time to complete the speech along with the 30 seconds of grace time. In case the speaker is unable to reconnect, then the backup speaker is to take over immediately. Even if more than one speaker of a team faces any kind of technical issues, only the same backup speaker will be permitted to replace the speakers. Now for the sequence of the speaking and the timing rules. The team which has been selected to speak for shall commence the debate. Speaker one of the team for the topic shall open and speak for a maximum of 3 minutes. Speaker one of team against the topic shall then open and speak for a maximum of 3 minutes. Speaker two of the team against shall speak for 3 minutes as a rebuttal to the opening speech of the team for the topic. Speaker two of the team for shall speak for 3 minutes as a rebuttal of the opening speech provided by the team against the topic. Speaker three of the team against shall provide the closing speech for a maximum of 2 minutes. And speaker three of the team four shall proceed with his closing speech for a maximum of 2 minutes. All speakers will be given a grace period of 10 seconds before they are muted. No new points or rebuttals shall be included in the speech after the first speaker of each team has conducted their address. At the completion of the maximum time inclusive of the grace period of the speaker, the timer shall mute the speaker. Timers, please note, timing for the opening and the rebuttal speaker, green light at 2.5 minutes. Red light at 3 minutes. Thank you. For the closing speaker, green light at 1.5 minutes and red light at 2 minutes. Thank you. 45 seconds between the speakers will be provided for the judges to mark the ballot, and 3 minutes at the end of the debate for the judges to tally the scores will be provided. Our chief judge this morning is DTM Ramesh Anantharaman. It is now time to begin the contest. Zoom master, are we ready? Timers, are we good to go? Now for the first preliminary rounds, please welcome the two teams, the Lethal Lions for the motion and Team Masterful Musketeers against the motion. As I call upon the team contestants, please say, I am ready for the battle. Representing Team Lethal Lions, we have the opening speaker, TM Robin Anand.
I am ready for the battle.
Perfect. The rebuttal speaker, TM Hashim Haleem.
I'm ready for the battle.
Good to go. The closing speaker for the team, TM Biju Nair.
I'm ready for the battle.
Excellent. We have the backup speaker, TM Vinod Panikkar.
I'm ready for the battle.
Good. Going against the team is the team Masterful Musketeers, represented by the opening speaker, TM Shubha Jose.
I'm ready for the battle.
Excellent. Rebuttal speaker, TM Madifilis Michael D'Souza.
I am ready for the battle.
Wonderful. The closing speaker for the day, TM Manikandan Rajagopal.
I'm ready for the battle.
Excellent. We have the backup speaker for the team, TM Ann Thomas.
I'm ready for the battle.
Wonderful. So the teams are ready to battle it out. Chief Judge, may I request your permission to proceed?
Please proceed.
Thank you so much, Chief Judge. The motion for the debate is, vaccination must be made mandatory. Vaccinations must be made mandatory. Now I would like to call the first speaker from Team Affirmative for the opening, TM Robin Anand.
Good morning to all. As a team, we are for the motion, vaccinations must be made mandatory. Let me define vaccination as per Cambridge Dictionary. The process or an act of giving someone a vaccine, a substance put into a person's body to prevent them getting a disease. Mandatory vaccination is a policy established by a national authority that requires that eligible individuals receive vaccination as defined by Vaccine Journal. Vaccination programs are one of the most successful and cost-effective public health interventions ever developed as per World Health Organization, WHO. Three important reasons to support mandatory vaccination. First, WHO named hesitancy to vaccinate as one of the top threats, global threats in 2019. Presently, over 105 countries have a nationwide mandatory vaccination policy requiring one or more vaccines. Of those, 62 countries impose one or more penalties for non-compliance, mostly financial or educational, such as refusing school enrollment. If the balance 90 countries also initiate mandatory vaccine policies, we could combat hesitancy to vaccinate and reduce death rates in these countries. Stats from Vaccine Journal, year 2020, study of 190 countries. Second point, herd immunity is the cornerstone of WHO's long-held plan to eradicate dangerous communicable diseases. WHO website states, herd immunity means virus will have trouble spreading when 80% plus of the population has immunity against it. Mandatory vaccination ensures that the risks and burdens of reaching herd immunity are distributed evenly across the population. When disease is under control, third point, the cases are a handful, we tend to take it easy and not bother vaccinating ourselves. But the last few percent of people can cause the resurgence of the disease. Hence, we need to have mandatory vaccinations to ensure no resurgence occurs. COVID-19 pandemic has helped us witness the impact of vaccines. Let us look back at some impressive stats from Global Vaccine Action Plan Report 2020 by WHO. From 2000 to 2018, 35 million deaths have been avoided. Further, deaths of 122 million people born between 2000 to 2030 can be prevented. This could include all our children. Smallpox 100% eradicated, polio 99% eradicated, measles 83% reduction. As a team, we strongly support the motion, vaccination should be made mandatory, because it's not just a good thing to do, but the right thing for the larger good of the mankind. Thank you.
Thank you, TM Robin. May I request timer 45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Thank you. Now I would like to call the constructive speaker from Team Negative, TM Shubha Jose.
India eradicated the epidemic poliovirus by 2011. Surely a phenomenal achievement. However, not by legislation, but by understanding concerns, removing stigmas, and educating public. Good morning, moderator, honorable jury, members of proposition, and dear audience. The motion on the floor is vaccination must be made mandatory. My team and I strongly negate the motion. Before we deliberate, let me define mandatory. It means made compulsory by law. We believe that vaccination is a great step towards the fight against the diseases which becomes an epidemic or pandemic. However, mandating vaccine and stigmatizing people who deny vaccines is too broad a brush to paint this issue with. Here are three main reasons that accentuate our stand. Firstly, if we fail to learn from history, then we are doomed. Dr. Edward Jenner's discovery of vaccination and the global eradication of smallpox rank among the greatest achievements in human history. However, smallpox still continues to be a scourge against humanity. And what about measles? It has been claiming lives of little children for decades. The Lancet, the most reliable medical journal, claims that between the countries that do not have mandatory vaccination to those that have, such as Bulgaria, Slovakia, there is no consistent difference in the rates of diseases. Hence, mandatory vaccination is not the key to eradication. Secondly, no vaccine offers 100% protection and vaccine efficacy. The Immunization Advisory Center states that a vaccine doesn't protect everyone equally. For some, the protection may wane over time, and a few end up with adverse effects. For instance, Jacobson, a Swedish immigrant, during an outbreak of smallpox, refused to comply with mandatory vaccination as he was suffering from immune suppression. He was found guilty. His appeal was finally heard by the US Supreme Court, which recognized the limitations and overruled the law of mandatory vaccination. Dear members of proposition, if you were in Jacobson's shoes, would you still be supporting the motion? Thirdly, mandatory vaccination impinges on the fundamental right and enforces anti-vaxxers. Another survey conducted by The Lancet found that the number of anti-vaxxers are increasing day by day, reaching up to 58 million globally. Hence, it has been proved that a government's mandate is not just met with unshakable defiance, but also is weaponized to recruit more anti-vaxxers. To conclude, I quote US Professor Wilrich, building public confidence in vaccine programs can be achieved only by continuous education. Hence, the motion on the floor must fall and the scales of justice be tipped in our favor. Over to you, moderator.
Thank you, TM Shubha. May I request timer 45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Now, I would like to call the rebuttal speaker from Team Negative, TM Mariphilis Michael D'Souza.
Good morning, respected moderator, panel of judges, and my dear members of proposition. Let me reaffirm that we strongly refute the motion on the floor. Vaccination should be made mandatory. Let me put forth few points to refute the arguments of my worthy opponents. While explaining the definition of vaccination, they said that every eligible individual should receive the vaccination. In that case, how can we make vaccination mandatory for the people with underlying health condition that weaken their immune system, such as cancer or HIV patient, or who have severe allergies to some vaccine components? Next, they spoke about the herd immunity. The World Health Organization itself states in the article of their Vaccine Explained series that no single vaccine provides 100% protection, and herd immunity does not provide full protection to those who cannot safely be vaccinated. They also spoke about the polio. But polio is eradicated in India, not because of the vaccination was mandatory, but, and the World Health Organization itself states that the key lesson that emanates from India's eradication of polio is that the social factors of a program implementation and are as important as the technical ones. And this lesson has a significance bearing on the other diseases elimination program as well. So rather making vaccination mandatory, educate the people. Again, they spoke about the countries where vaccination is made mandatory and where it is not mandatory. But my opening speaker has already mentioned the Lancet report stating that there is not much difference in the health condition of the people in the country where the vaccination is mandatory and where it is not. They also gave the example of COVID, telling COVID has helped us or taught us the importance of vaccination. But we all know that before rolling out the vaccination into the market, there has to be a procedure to follow, which takes 4 to 5 years. And we all know this is not done in the case of COVID vaccination. Also, we know that in India, people have already taken the vaccination, and now it is said that that vaccine is not valid. Still, we want to continue saying that vaccination should be made mandatory. So I strongly believe, me and my team strongly believe that vaccination should never be made mandatory. Hence,
thank you, TM Mariphilis. Requesting 45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Now I would like to call the rebuttal speaker from Team Affirmative, TM Hashim Haleem.
Let us save the world one drop at a time. My team and I firmly stand for the motion, vaccinations must be made mandatory. Now this topic is about vaccinations and immunization, and let's look what our worthy opponents have brought out for us today. They started out with a statistic claiming that India eradicated polio by 2011 by not by governmental intervention, but by learning and teaching, etc. Fair enough, but when did the polio epidemic start in India in the first place? It's been prevalent since the 1950s. So if we had a mandatory vaccination policy at that time, we could have eradicated it much earlier and saved so many million Indians who have died because of this, clearly proving that making vaccinations mandatory would have been the greatest step that we could have done in the fight against polio. Moving on, my very worthy opponent started talking about smallpox. Smallpox again, Edward Jenner, smallpox one more time. I think smallpox has led to small thoughts. Smallpox is already eradicated. We have already seen the results of that 100% eradication. No relevance in this speech, in this debate whatsoever. She cited one study, one survey, which stated that between countries, there is no consistent difference between the spread of diseases. Without mentioning which diseases were being considered, what was the population size being considered, or anything of that sort, absolutely no value. I think besides the immunization, this speech has been immune to logic as well. She went on to give an example of Jacobson, yet another case of a smallpox. There are many cases which are there out, like, for example, the case of Matheson versus Massachusetts, wherein the government ruled that it has to follow the state's policy rather than each individual's rights in the case of epidemics which are spread. So very clearly, there is enough evidence to support that many, as my opener has said, 100 countries across the world have adopted a mandatory vaccine policy. Why shouldn't we? Moving on, you went on to talk about the fundamental right. This is my life. This is my health. Why are you bothered? This would work if you were sitting in an desolate, isolated island in the middle of the Pacific Ocean where there is only you and a coconut tree. That is not the case. You live in a society where you are responsible to keep yourself, your family, and the people around you safe. Take a few drops, save a few lives. Moving on, you said that instead of giving mandatory vaccines, you should give education. I do not see why you cannot do both. You can give education and still have a policy around vaccination. Like my opener said, 105 countries have done that. The remaining 90 should too. In the end, just like the vaccines, there is immunization. This has been immune to logic altogether. Therefore, I stand firmly for the motion that vaccinations must be made mandatory. Vaccinations are a drop of life. Prevent, protect, preserve. Back to you, moderator.
Thank you, TM Hashim. Requesting 45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Now I would like to call the summary speaker from Team Negative, TM Manigandan Rajagopal.
We, the opposition, firmly negate the motion on the floor. Vaccination must be made mandatory. Honorable moderator, respected judges, and dear audience, Good morning. Let me begin by reinforcing what our opening speaker stated. He declared that mandating vaccines is not the correct approach to eradicate a disease. She further went on to state three reasons why we strongly oppose the motion. First, mandatory vaccination is not the key to eradication. Mankind continues to be victims of the effects of vaccination against the monstrous diseases. Secondly, no vaccine offers 100% protection and vaccine efficacy. Vaccines, though effective in preventing infections, may have long-term adverse effects. Thirdly, mandatory vaccination impinges on the fundamental right and enforces so-called anti-vaxxers. The statement thus put forth by our opening speaker were suitably substantiated with authentic surveys and statistics. Next, our rebuttal speaker strongly refuted the claim of the proposition. First, she busted the myth that no single vaccine provides 100% protection. She emphasized that the World Health Organization states that the social factors of a program implementation are as important as the technical ones. Secondly, she stated the glaring truth that according to the Lancet, the number of anti-vaxxers are increasing day by day and making vaccines mandatory risk the lives of people. Finally, she said that vaccination cannot be made mandatory for the people with underlying health conditions who have weak immune system. Therefore, we, the opposition, firmly reaffirm our stance and appeal to the House to negate the motion that vaccination should be made mandatory. Over to you, moderator.
Thank you, TM Manigandan. Request timer 45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Moving on, I will call the summary speaker from Team Affirmative, TM Biju Nair.
Super good morning, everyone. Vaccinations must be made mandatory, and we strongly stand for the motion because it is just not a good thing to do, but the right thing for the larger good of mankind. Let me reiterate the points my team has detailed with conviction and substantiated arguments why the entire House should support this motion. My opening speaker defined vaccination and the mandatory vaccination, which is the policy established by the national authority that eligible individuals receive vaccination. Vaccination programs are one of the most successful and cost-effective public health interventions ever developed by as per WHO. Three key reasons why it should be made mandatory. Number one, hesitancy to vaccinate is quoted as a top global health threat in 2019 as per WHO. 105 countries mandated vaccination, of which 62 countries have imposed vaccination for non-compliance, with penalties on non-compliance. So vaccination being mandatory is not a new term. If more countries make it mandatory, it accelerates death reduction. Point number two, vaccination should help us reach herd immunity. And herd immunity is a cornerstone of WHO's long health plan to eradicate dangerous communicable diseases. Point number three, mandatory vaccinations ensures no resurgence occurs. GVAP report by WHO says vaccination have almost halved the number of deaths caused by vaccine preventable diseases. From 2000 to 2018, 35 million deaths have been avoided. My rebuttal speaker discredited the strenuous and the lacunae-ridden points put forward by my opponents. For the point which raised by the opponents on the India eradicated the vaccination in 2000, India eradicated smallpox polio in 2011 was being negated, stating that, you know, the smallpox by itself came in the 1950s, and if mandatory vaccination should have been done, it would have been eradicated much early. The point which has been raised on the smallpox required a small thoughts, and the differences quoted between the non-mandatory and mandatory countries but not been detailed without any substantiated figures, which has been completely exposed by our rebuttal speaker. and also on the fundamental rights and the fundamental rights stats across for the security, for the social and the society across. So in conclusion,
Thank you, TM Biju Nair and the teams. May I request timer 3 minutes for the judges to mark the ballot. Meanwhile, Zoom Master, please share the participation certificates. Thank you, Zoom Master. Zoom Master, could you please take a group picture of the contestants? Contestants of PR1, may I request you to switch on your cameras and be ready for the group picture and flash that wonderful smile.
Thank you, done.
Thank you, Zoom Master. May I request the contestants of PR2 to switch on the cameras and be ready? And others, please keep your camera switched off. With this, we come to the end of the first preliminary round debate between the Lethal Lions and the Masterful Musketeers. Let us give both the teams a huge round of applause. It's now time to begin the next debate. Zoom Master, are we good to go? Timers, are we ready? Yes. For our second debate in the preliminary rounds, we have the brilliant Bravehearts pitted against the cool Crusaders. As I call upon each contestant, please say, I am ready for the battle. Speaking for the motion are the brilliant Bravehearts represented by opening speaker T.N. Sandipta Ghosh. Could you please unmute?
Sorry, I'm ready for the battle.
Excellent. The rebuttal speaker for the team, TM Hariharan Iyer.
I'm ready for the battle.
Wonderful. Closing speaker, TM Ruth Fernandez.
I am ready for the battle.
Thank you. Backup speaker for the team, TM George Joseph.
I am ready for the battle.
Excellent. Speaking against the motion, we have the Cool Crusaders represented by the opening speaker, TM Kalpana Prakash.
I am ready for the battle. Good morning.
Good morning and thank you. Rebuttal speaker, TM Garuda Prakash.
I am ready for the battle.
Thank you. Closing speaker for the team, TM Faisal Ibrahim.
I am ready for the battle.
Thank you. Backup speaker for this team, TM Avare Nayagam.
I'm ready for the battle.
Thank you. Thank you, team. Chief Judge, do I have your permission to begin?
Just give me 30 seconds, please.
Sure.
You can proceed now. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief Judge. The motion for this debate is, technology has led to increase in crime. Technology has led to the increase in crime. Now, I would like to call the first speaker from Team Affirmative for the opening, TM Sandipta Ghosh.
Technological process is like an axe in the hands of a criminal, quotes Albert Einstein. Good morning, respected judges, toastmasters, and guests, and of course, my worthy opponents. We as a team firmly stand for the motion. Technology has led to an increase in crime. And we shall, without a shred of doubt today, prove our stand to this august house. Merriam-Webster dictionary defines technology as a manner of accomplishing a task, especially using process, methods, knowledge. Increase, become progressively greater. Crime, grave against, offense against morality. So simply put, the motion on the floor today is employing technological processes, methods, and knowledge as a means to commit grave immoral offenses. In his book, Guns, Germs, and Steel, Jared Diamond writes, and I quote, "The first crime was committed with only sticks and stones, destroying a hamlet, replaced by bows and arrows, destroying kingdoms. Then came the guns and the cannons and destroyed empires. Later, artillery, fighter jets, felling countries. And now, cyber hacks, unmanned aerial and ground vehicles taking over. This is how technology has facilitated the growth of crime over the years. You have won $1 million, reads a message on your phone. You're smiling, aren't you? You know this is a scam. 2020 Internet Crime Report released by FBI's Internet Crime Complaint Center noted a whopping 69.4% increase in cybercrime from 2019, reporting losses exceeding $4.2 billion only in the US. Top three crimes, phishing, non-payment, non-delivery scams, extortion, ransomware. UNODC report of 24th September 2020 states money laundering, 2% or 5% of the world's GDP and growing. Terrorist financing, immoral practices, these are the biggest crimes globally, all facilitated through the latest channels of technology. To live a life free of crime, immoral practices, we must ensure technological progress is not handed over to the criminals to be used as an axe. Therefore, as a team, we strongly stand today for the motion that technology has led to an increase in crime. We rest our case.
Thank you, TM Ghosh. Requesting 45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Thank you, Timer. Now I would like to call the constructive speaker from Team Negative, TM Kalpana Prakash.
Good morning, dear moderator, my worthy opponents, and to all the Sherlock Holmes and the James Bonds here who will believe that our team is against the motion that technology has led to increase in crime. Crime, as defined by the Oxford Dictionary, is an action or omission which constitutes an offense and is punishable by law. The science and technology has given us incredible and powerful crime-fighting mechanisms with which the enforcement agencies are well-equipped to reduce the crime. Let me present a few facts today. As per the article of the Wired.co.uk, December 2016, there's a dramatic reduction in the crime rates over the last 20 years, and because technology has made it harder to commit the crimes.
They have listed that the car crime, which is reduced by more than 50% across the developed countries in UK at 1/6 of the early 90s levels. Much of the shift is the result of the slow spread of the central locking and the electronic immobilizers. In the same article, a study led by the University of Massachusetts, Professor Anthony Harris, found that the US murder rates might have been 3 times higher today were it not for the advances in communication and medical technologies. The research conducted in Purdue University in USA 2018, the state-of-the-art gunshot technology detects gunfire, gives police officer instant access to the shooting location maps, as well as information on how many shooters are present and how many shots were fired. The Chicago Police Department has seen success with this technology, as both the shooting incidents and the homicides have been decreased at least by 40% in the years 2016 and 17. An Indian company called Stack Technologies has set out to use the artificial intelligence-powered predictive policing, which is being also used by the Dubai police force, aiming at a 25% reduction in the violent crimes. Haven't we seen in UAE national newspaper on April 2nd, they reported the arrest of Bouchibi, a French drug trafficking and smuggling criminal, using the facial recognition technology, who was on the run for over 10 years in Europe. Isn't that a good technology? Now, today morning newspaper edition of the National News UAE carried an article that the Dubai police is also smart to combat home break-ins. At high-tech home security service, alerting police and the homeowners in Dubai to crimes as they happen has helped to slash the burglary rates. Residents can sign up to the Dubai police app and notify officers when they'll be away for prolonged periods so that their homes can be monitored. Homeowners can also track surveillance footage on their phones. Dear Toastmaster, as evidence across the globe, whether it be in America, Europe, Middle East, India, the law enforcement agencies are taking the help of the latest technology, AI, face recognition, digital surveillance. So our team strongly believes that technology is helping.
Thank you, TM Kalpana. Timer 45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot, please. Thank you, timer. Now I would like to call the rebuttal speaker from Team Negative, TM Garuda Prakash.
Dear moderator, the opening speaker, Toastmaster Sayan Dipta of the Worthy Opponent team. Good morning. Sir, I applaud your presentation. It sounded like watching a science fiction movie with all the criminals let loose by downloading their brain power and using technological gadgets. However, it's my privilege and honor to rebut the following points. Sir, you talked about $1 million by email. Isn't it in our hands to control our greed? For your information, the Homeland Security published 3 simple tips in November 2020. First one, keep a clean machine. Update the security software and operating system on your computer. When in doubt, throw it out. Stop and think before you open any attachments or click links in emails. Use stronger authentication. The data breach is all dependent on how many web surfers are following these 3 simple tips. You also talked about money laundering and terrorism. As we know, human brain is a complex system of strategies. Criminals find various ways to conduct crime, but at the same time, human had found more ways through which criminals could be caught and punished. As per CNBC, the DarkTrace immune system is a market-leading cybersecurity technology platform that uses artificial intelligence to detect sophisticated cyber threats, from insider threat to criminal espionage. You also talked about different types of cyber crimes globally. Maybe if I can refer to the Interpol symposium held in South Africa in 2019, which discussed on various types of crime at a global level. The categories of crime are drug trafficking, arms trafficking, human trafficking, vehicle crime, organized crime, burglary. All these play a very vital role in the society. Drug trafficking and arms trafficking accounts for over 60% of the crime put together globally. I mean, not necessarily by using technology, even by the simple ways what has been followed in the past and today. So why do you single out only cyber crime? By providing various ways of dealing with the crime, technology has made communities safer places to live and work in. The technology is always helping the enforcement authorities to control the crime. Facial recognition and fingerprint technology, which is widely used all over the world, has helped the police to control the crime and also minimize the cyber theft. With this, I rest my case. Back to you, moderator.
Thank you, TM Garuda Prakash. Timer requests 45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot, please. Thank you, Timer. Now I would like to call the rebuttal speaker from Team Affirmative, TM Hariharan Iyer.
Technology is like an axe in the hands of a criminal. Contest Chair, fellow Toastmasters, ladies and gentlemen, wish you all a good morning. To all the James Bonds and the Sherlock Holmes in the house, I think we forgot James Bond and Sherlock Holmes are always trying to chase the technology that was trying to destroy the world. So I think from the very beginning, our opposition got the plot a little wrong. Please wake up and smell the coffee, because you are in a figment of your imagination. Opposition, let me tell you, why do I feel so? And what is the reason you possibly gave it away? Number one, you said that enforcement agencies are able to use technology to find criminals. Trust me, criminals have already used the technology and you are just doing catch up. You're just doing catch up, number one. Number two, you said that there is a reduction in crime. Must I tell you, the latest report of 2020, October, by the WHO, very clearly states that crime is happening in different other forms, not only in the forms of cyber attacks. Let me tell you, biological warfare is one of those biggest ones that you never even spoke about. And that is the one that we are fearing the most. Gone are the days when we would be worrying about gunshots being fired and possibly even cyber attacks. Cyber attacks is something of the past. Number three, very important, and I think you missed it there. You said that in the United States, the reduction of crime has come down. I must tell you, if you open the newspaper, you open BBC, you open any television channel, every alternate day, you find somebody has shot 20 people, 30 people, 50 people. What's happening, my dear friends? As per the latest report from the Homeland Security, which was tabled on the 21st of March of this very same year, states that crime has gone up by 22% in the period of the lockdown. That means, try and understand, it is your technology that is motivating people to do what they are doing. Number three, you very clearly stated that car crimes have come down. Imagine, car crimes have come down since the last 50 damn long years. Trust me, car crimes are no more followed. Today, people are more worried about your identity. They want to steal your identity and use it somewhere else. That is why you find so many banks getting fined for actually letting down their firewall protection. Let me share some more information. In fact, the entire losses in the world is over $3.2 trillion, which was reported by the FCA, the Financial Control Authority in the United Kingdom, only from frauds and impersonation of identity. My dear opponents, let's not forget that technology will progress, and that is why your crimes also graduate. You will only be catching up because technology is an axe in the hands of a criminal. Contest chair.
Thank you, TM Hariharan. Timer requesting 45 minutes for the judges to mark the ballot, please. Thank you, Timer. Now I would like to call the summary speaker from Team Negative, TM Faisal Ibrahim.
Dear debate moderator, Toastmasters, and worthy opponents, a very good morning to one and all. I am sure the facts and the figures given by our opening speaker must have convinced you all, and including our worthy opponent, that technology is helping to reduce crime, not increasing. She quoted the article from wired.co.uk of December 2016 edition, where it is stated that dramatic reduction in the crime rate over the last 20 years because technology has made it harder to commit crime. Further, she has mentioned that in the UK, the car crime has been reduced more than 50% due to the central locking and the electronic immobilizer. And lastly, to prove her point, she mentioned two important studies from the University of Massachusetts and the Purdue University with examples how technology has helped to reduce the crime. To add on, a rebuttal speaker has nullified all the factless argument by giving a very strong evidence. When they listed so many crimes, and my reporter rightly pointed out which specific gadgets or the electronic devices have been used to stop $1 million scams and other bigger crimes listed by our opponent, it is in our hands. And he has mentioned three important guidelines issued by the Homeland Security, which is released recently. As per the organization like CNBC, community is a safer place to live and work. They use the facial technology, facial recognition, and different AI technologies to reduce the crime, not to increase the crime. Everybody wants to live in a country where there is a zero crime. Today, it is time for you to think and decide along with us by voting against the notion that technology has led to an increase in the crime. Technology has led people to be happy and peaceful, isn't it?
Thank you, TM Faisal. 45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot, please. Timer. Thank you, Timer. Now I would like to call the summary speaker from Team Affirmative, TM Ruth Fernandez.
Thank you. Technological progress is like an axe in the hands of a criminal, an Albert Einstein quote with which our opening speaker introduced the motion, technology has led to an increase in crime. Greeting contest chair, Toastmasters and our worthy opponents. Three salient points to prove the motion. The evolution of technology has led to the revolution of crime, from the past to the present, from sticks and stones to cyber attacks and the use of unmanned aerial and ground vehicles. Reference, the book Guns, Germs and Steals by Jared Diamond. Two, in 2020, FBI reported 69.4% increase in crime, amounting to $4.2 billion in losses. Three, the UNODC report of September 2020 on money laundering and terrorist financing amounts to 2% to 5% of the world's GDP, all facilitated by technology. Our rebuttal speaker refuted the arguments of the opposition with three important points. Enforcement agencies are simply playing catch-up while criminals are already using technology to commit the crime. WHO says crime is happening in different other forms, not just cyber crimes. What about biological warfare? Not discussed at all. USA crime is reduced. Every day you hear about 35, 40 people being shot. Crime has increased by 22% in the lockdown period, all motivated by technology. Car crimes? Forget about car crimes, they're obsolete. We are talking about stealing identity. Why are banks worried about our information? I urge the House to vote in our favor. Technology has indeed led to an increase in crime. And I request the House to vote. Thank you.
Thank you, TM Ruth. Timer, 3 minutes for the judges to mark the ballots. Zoom Master, may I request you to share the participation certificates, please? Thank you, Zoom Master. Contestants, please switch on your cameras and be ready for the group picture. Zoom Master, could you please take the group photograph, please?
It's done. Thank you.
Thank you, team. Thank you, Zoom Master. With that, we come to the end of the second preliminary round debate between the Brilliant Bravehearts and the Cool Crusaders. Let us give both the teams a huge round of applause. It's now time to begin the next debate. The next team, please be ready with your camera switched on, and I request the rest of the participants, please switch off your cameras. Zoom Master and Timer, hope we are good to go with PR3. In our third preliminary round debate, we have the Articulate Avengers battling it out with the Nifty Ninjas. As I call upon the contestant, please say, I'm ready for the battle. Speaking for the motion are the Articulate Avengers, represented by the opening speaker, TM Lina Alkurd. Could you please switch on your mic?
Good morning. I'm ready for the contest.
Excellent. The rebuttal speaker for the team, TM Dana Nashavati.
I am ready for the battle.
Thank you. Closing speaker, TM Ghassan Al Musa.
Ready for the battle.
Wonderful. We have the backup speaker, TM Noor Al Nahlia. Speaking against the motion are the Nifty Ninjas, represented by the opening speaker, TM Nesma.
Evening. Good morning. I'm ready for the battle.
Excellent. The rebuttal speaker for the team, TM Kishore.
I'm ready for the battle.
Excellent. Closing speaker, TM Mohammad Asif.
I'm ready for the battle.
Thank you. The backup speaker for the team, TM Elroy Vaz. Thank you, teams. Seeking chief judge's permission to proceed, please.
Please go ahead.
Thank you, chief judge. The motion for this battle is entry fee at tourist attractions should be subsidized for the citizens. Entry fee at the tourist attractions should be subsidized for the citizens. Now, I would like to call the first speaker from Team Affirmative for the opening, TM Lina.
Madam Contest Moderator, Honorable Judges, ladies and gentlemen, our team is with the motion that entry fee at tourist attractions should be subsidized for citizens. Before we convince you why we believe so, let me explain why tourism in general and domestic tourism in particular are important. Globally, the tourism sector accounts for over 10% of the global domestic product GDP, according to the Economic Impact Report 2017. The European Scientific Journal in 2020 listed the benefits of domestic tourism by citizens, such as achieved balance in the national economy, nourishing not only tourism, but also the supporting sectors as well, including transportation and catering. I have no doubt that all of you know how hard COVID-19 pandemic hit the tourism sector with all these restrictions for international tourists. That was pointed out in different publications by IMF, IATA, and the World Trade Organization. So encouraging citizens to visit domestic sites became even more crucial nowadays to compensate for the shortage in international visits. Entrance fees for citizens must be subsidized to encourage citizens to go out of their home, take their kids, their friends, and visit their country sites. Subsidized entrance is a mercy, not only to the aching economies around the world, but also a mercy on the middle and low income citizens. In Jordan, for example, which is no different than many countries around the globe, and based on a study by Middle East University in 2017, domestic tourism accounts only for 7% of the total activities because of the low per capita income, which makes the citizens' ability to spend money on tourism very, very low. Don't you agree with us that all citizens, regardless of their income, are equally They equally deserve to enjoy domestic yet relatively cheap trip in their own country? I'm sure you all do. Ladies and gentlemen, domestic tourism is necessary to the economy, but we cannot promote it without incentives to the makers of it, the actual taxpayers in the country, the citizens. Citizens deserve subsidized entrance fees. It's their right. My team and I believe that it's their right. as much as visiting their country's treasures and maximizing their sense of belonging to their national identity and history is. Please join us in advocating for a subsidized entrance fees to all citizens. Thank you, and back to you.
Thank you, TM Lina. Timer, may I request 45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot, please. Thank you, Timer. Moving on to the next speaker, the constructive speaker from Team Negative, TM Najma.
My team and I strongly believe that entry fees for tourist attractions should not be subsidized. We have many reasons for saying so. Firstly, if we subsidize the entry fees for tourist attractions, there will be certain negative effects, such as dead weight loss, which would in turn lead to market inefficiency. Now, what do I mean by dead weight loss? Well, dead weight loss is when the supply and demand are not in equilibrium. And what happens due to this dead weight loss is market inefficiency, which is when the prices of certain goods and services are either overvalued or undervalued. So these two reasons are a main thing why we should not subsidize entry fees. To give some statistical proof, in the entire world, there is $8.8 trillion that is generated as income through the tourism industry. So if we take even a small tiny percentage of that $1 trillion, it would be billions of dollars. So the earlier mentioned marketing inefficiencies and all would lead to the loss of billions of dollars. So I believe this is a valid reason for the argument that we are going with. Now, the second thing is that differential treatment. Imagine I'm standing in a line waiting to go to a particular tourist attraction. You know what would happen? The person standing in front of me might be a citizen and I might be a tourist, but we both, if the entry fees are subsidized, would be paying vastly different fees. Differential treatment, which is definitely frowned upon in this day and age. Thirdly, what I would like to say is that governments generally subsidize necessities, and by necessities, I mean food, gas, healthcare services, etc., and not leisure activities. If you look at Maslow's hierarchy of needs, you can clearly see that at the top is necessities, while in the lower levels only we can see leisure activities such as tourism. So to give a summary, three main points that we are putting forward as to why we should not subsidize the entry fees to tourist attractions is: number one, it would lead to dead weight losses and market inefficiencies. Second, it would lead to differential treatment between people. And the third and the last point that we would like to convey is that it is not a necessity. Government should be subsidizing necessities as opposed to leisure activities. Over to the moderator.
Thank you, TM Najma. Requesting timer 45 minutes for the judges to mark the ballot, please. Thank you, Timer. Now I would like to call the rebuttal speaker from Team Affirmative, from Team Negative, sorry, TM Kishore.
Hi. So, Madam Moderator, my fellow Toastmasters, and our opponents this morning, a very good morning to all of you. Our opposition, the Articulate Avengers, this morning tried to make a strong case for subsidies for citizens visiting local tourist attractions. I want to stand and take this opportunity to rebut some of the arguments that were made by the speaker who made a for argument for this motion. Let me start with some of the points that were raised. The very first point that was raised was the domestic tourism is more important than international tourism. I strongly disagree with that, because if you just promote domestic tourism and promote a lot of volumes of domestic tourists visiting your local tourist attractions and you subsidize them, how are you going to get the revenues? It's going to be a huge drag on the government's spending and the revenues and the eventual budget, which creates, and we have experiences from the past with emerging markets where you get into what can be called a currency crisis. And our speaker this morning also said about the COVID-19 impact. And in fact, I would use the same argument to say that you should not subsidize tourist fees for your locals and the citizens in comparison to the internationals, because if you think about countries like Italy, they have been subsidizing the international tourism by paying one night stay for international tourists and trying to subsidize the airfares for international tourists when they travel domestically. So within Italy, between two cities, that's getting subsidized. So when countries are going all the way, bending backwards to encourage the international travel, why do you just want to focus on domestic tourism and just by promoting subsidies to them? And I also heard the word mercy when it came to subsidy. Yes, our speaker this morning was trying to appeal to the pathos within us and trying to get to the human perspective of it. But I must tell you that as an economist in the profession I am in, the tourist revenues are just business. So you have your country boasts a particular monument and you want foreigners to come and spend here, and it is just business. And the same applies also for the domestic travel. There is little in terms of the mercy that you can talk about. And there is also argument that it's your own country. Yes, that's right. If you are a citizen of one or two countries at most, but remember there are 190 plus countries there out there where you will be considered a tourist. Actual taxpayers, being the taxpayers local, and I think that's a very narrow view to take, and instead think about the global perspective. We being the global citizens, we are sort of free to travel between borders, and I think we should keep that in mind. To summarize, given that some of the arguments on which the case for the motion for the argument has been rebutted, I request the House to strongly vote.
Thank you, TM Kishore. Timer, 45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Thank you, Timer. Moving on, I would like to call the rebuttal speaker from Team Affirmative, TM Dana.
What do you prefer? A guaranteed, slightly reduced income from the locals, or an unpredicted, seasonal, up in the air, high income by international tourists? Dear contest chair, judges and Toastmasters, good morning. The respected opposing team had several major fallacies in their argument, and let me systematically and logically point out the key false notions and error in reasoning. Our worthy opponent pointed to dead waste loss under referencing the economic supply and demand team. But you got it wrong. It's not a loss in income. It actually generates income. Local tourism generates income. As I speak today, COVID-19 has debilitated the entire world, and I agree with you that we will overcome this. And we are, as we speak today, international tourism is paralyzed. And it will take time, according to the World Economic Forum, until the end of 2021, according to experts. And the outlook right now is very dire. What do we do until that time? What do we do in these 2 years? And it's not just COVID-19. It's not the only determinant that affects international tourism. Just state a few, like the world economic recession, terrorist attacks, security concerns, they all affect international tourism. And according to the International Journal of Business Tourism and Applied Science that was published in 2013 by Reg et al., there is a differential effect of economic crisis, epidemics, and tourism on tourists. What do we do in these situations? We don't need to tackle the problem. We need to face it. And the only way where you don't have international tourists is to generate the income from local citizens that contribute to the economy at large. And it's the fastest, easiest, and direct solution. The second point, our worthy opponent stated that tourists would not like the differential treatment, that there is maybe price discrimination, and several studies, and I'm going to mention just one of them that was published in the Journal of Business Ethics as recent as 2020 with a high impact journal under progressive pricing, the ethical case for price personalization by Pocher and Izaret. The authors of the paper argue that price discrimination or differential treatment is more ethical than unitary pricing when done progressively, meaning charging customers as a function of their willingness to pay. World-renowned experts mentioned that in the beginning that it's hard for locals sometimes to pay more, but we have to look at the facts at hand, and you leave our position strong.
Thank you, TM Dana. Judges, 45 seconds to mark the ballot. Timer, please note. Thank you, Timer. Moving on, I would like to call the summary speaker from Team Negative, TM Mohammed Asif.
Moderator, panel of judges, am I the Toastmasters? Tourist attraction should not be subsidized for local citizens. My team members, Nasma, already mentioned the reason why we stand for one, dead weight loss, a disequilibrium in such a huge industry, $8.9 trillion industry, affecting many, many millions of jobs. Second, what about your your own feelings. Imagining yourself standing in a line and two differential treatment meted out at two different people. Oh my God, how do you feel paying that money for your plane tickets and your tour, your hotels? And somebody standing, sitting over next and paying cheap money for that. So subsidies comes to, we come to the third point. Subsidies are for what? It's a tool where governments have used it for helping the local citizens for necessities. Necessities like your gas, your medical, healthcare. So going on, these three important things. It's a disequilibrium in a huge industry causing job losses. It's going to be a differential treatment. Nobody likes it. Third, you're only for essential things. Now coming to the opponents, which they said local versus international, they are contributing a lot. If they are contributing a lot, then there is no need to subsidize it because that's your own revenue. Why do you want to subsidize it? Taking Italy, my goodness, Italy is going backwards. That's the reason. For example, that's the all tourist industry countries, friendly tourist countries, are go thinking global.
Thank you, TM Mohammad Asif. Timer, please note 45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot, please. Thank you, timer. Now calling the final speaker for PR3, calling on TM Ghassan.
Thank you very much. I want to thank both of my colleagues for presenting the wonderful arguments in this issue. I'm going to start by my colleague Lina, who started by saying that the domestic tourism contributes to over 10% of the overall GDP. If you're going to be thinking percentage, that might not sound much. If you think numbers, if it's out of 100 billion, you're talking about 10 billion. Unfortunately, as also she said, the impact of COVID-19 over international tourism is that it has reduced its activity to less than 7%. And she also supported subsidizing entry fees because it will boost the economy for all local citizens because they are eligible to enjoy their local sites with reduced cost as it's their traditional treasure, heritage, and it's their rightful ownership. Now, we moved further as my colleague Dana also mentioned a couple of very important points as a response to the other team. At the beginning and most important of all is the stability of income versus the variety of income. As the old proverb says, one bird in hand is much better than 10 flying on the tree. If you are going to be counting on billions that could be coming from international tourists that you don't know are they going to come or not, according to her feedback, but you know for a fact that domestic tourism is always going to be there because the local citizens will always visit these sites. The international tourism has been paralyzed due to COVID and due to many other factors that we don't have time to mention all of them, but COVID, terrorism, vandalism. The situation has become really complicated. And when your solution doesn't work, you find a new solution. And according to my colleague, Dana, international tourism is much more fragile and it's so easily affected and impacted. And that's why we believed that because the international tourism became very impacted, we need to reallocate.
Thank you, TM Carson. Requesting timer to please note 3 minutes for the judges to mark the ballot. Zoom master, please share the participation certificates for this PR3. Thank you, Zoom Master. May I request the contestants of PR3 to switch on your cameras and be ready for that wonderful group picture. Zoom Master, please take the group picture.
Thank you.
May I request the contestants of PR4 to be ready with their camera switched on and others requesting you to switch off for more clarity. With that, we have come to the end of the third preliminary round debate between the Articulate Avengers and the Nifty Ninjas. Let us give both the teams a huge round of applause for their wonderful performance. It is now time for the next debate. The next battle. Zoom masters and timers, hope you are ready and good to go. In the fourth preliminary round debate, we have the Team Invincible Icons pitted against Team Judicious Jaguars. Speaking for the motion are the Invincible Icons, represented by the opening speaker, TM Amita.
Good morning.
Requesting each contestant to unmute themselves and say, I'm ready for the battle, as and when
I'm ready for the battle.
Thank you, TM Amita. The rebuttal speaker for the team, TM Tina.
I'm ready for the battle.
Excellent. Closing speaker for the team, TM Manpreet Kaur.
I'm ready for the battle.
Thank you. We have the backup speaker, TM Anirudh Diora.
I'm ready for the battle.
Thank you. Speaking against the motion, we have the Judicious Jaguars, represented by the opening speaker, TM Alina Satish.
I'm ready for the battle.
Excellent. The rebuttal speaker for the team, TM Sanaya Parker.
I am ready for the battle.
Thank you. Closing speaker, TM Akshara Suresh.
I am ready for the battle.
Thank you. We have the backup speaker, TM Siddhartha Hegde. May I request the chief judge to grant permission to proceed with PR4?
Please wait for a few seconds.
Sure.
Yeah, you can go ahead now. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief Judge. The motion for this battle is the fees for online classes must be reduced by educational institutions. The fees for online classes must be reduced by educational institutions. Now, I would like to call the first speaker from the team affirmative for the opening, TM Amita.
Good morning. My team and I stand for the motion, fees for online classes must be reduced by educational institutions. Cambridge defines online classes as a course conducted over the internet. They are generally conducted through a learning management system in which students can view their course syllabus and academic progress, as well as communicate with fellow students and their course instructor. An educational institution is an organization which carries out educational activity. The concept of online learning is not new. It has been in play for over a decade. Legislature and judiciary systems are recognizing it all over the world. On July 31st, 2020, Philippine Senator Maria Marcos stated that schools should not be playing blind and profiting on what they would no longer provide. Parents and students should definitely be paying less. The Future of Online Learning by Ashley Murphy, dated June 17, 2019, states the prices for online learning course for comparable on-campus degree costed around 50% less in the regions US and the UK. In March 2021, the University of Seattle announced that except for tuition fees, it will suspend other recreation fees, graduate activity fees, and other additional fees because for them, the facilities and resources which are not used by the students should not be charged. In May 2021, as per the Supreme Court of India, the Bench of Justice led by Mr. Khanwilkar said that by law, the school management cannot be heard to collect fees in respect of activities and facilities which are not provided to or availed by its students due to circumstances beyond their control. Demanding fees, even in respect of overheads on such activities, would be nothing short of indulging in profiteering and commercialization. The Forbes article on 6 November 2020 wonderfully highlighted this point. However stricken university finances are, and however hard university staff have been working, it is not for students to bail them out. edX, an online platform for free online courses by Harvard, MIT, and more, has been providing free courses since February 2012, as they realized back then that the cost of hosting these courses online is far less than compared to the traditional on-campus training. While one cannot put a price on the value of education, online education adds the extra cost of electronic gadgets, listening devices, and internet. The onus of this falls heavily on the parents. So reducing the fees for online classes would reduce this financial burden. If there are parents here, the fees for online classes is reduced, why wouldn't you be happy? Hence, I conclude by stating strongly that my team and I stand for the...
Thank you, TM Amita. May I request the timer 45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Also, one announcement, please. All other speakers, if you are not participating at the moment, requesting you to switch off your mics. Thank you, timer. Reiterating once again, kindly mute yourself if you are not speaking. Calling upon the next speaker for the day, the constructive speaker from Team Negative, TM Alina.
Good morning, fellow Toastmasters, moderators, and judges.
Team Judicious Jaguar speaks against the motion. Fees for online classes must be reduced by educational institutions. Let us start by defining a few key terms from Britannica. Fees, a payment made to a professional person or a professional body in exchange for advice or services. An educational institution is defined as a place where different ages gain an education, including preschool, schools, universities as well. They provide a large variety of learning environment and learning spaces as well. Team Judicious Jaguar speaks against the motion strongly for the following reasons. Quality of education provided is the same, so why are we questioning a reduction in fee? According to Forbes 2020, in UK universities, lecturers have done enough to provide the same delivery of resources online and have adapted to newer technologies and softwares such as AR and VR, so students can easily engage with discussions and engage with material as well. The providers of education are not lacking in any manner, so why should educational institutions reduce their fee? Insider Ed in 2016 showed research that there has been an increase in online teaching from 39% in 2016 to 40% in 2019. In a growing market with continuous improvements, we should actually raise the question of added investment rather than reduction. Mode of delivery existed since a very long time, and the prices of those courses have been the same then. Insider Ed research in 2016 shows that online courses have existed for 22 years. The US Department of Education and Research conducted in the University of Denver and also in the year of 2012 show that chief academic leaders believe that this is important to the long-term strategy of online learning and learning in general. 20.6 million students enrolled in higher education. From them, 6.7 million are enrolled in in online courses. And what does this say? They have known the prices of these courses. They have still enrolled themselves because they see benefit in it. They know the prices are worth it and they know what they can afford. Now, let me show you an example. With music teachers trying to teach students instruments, or with teachers in primary schools trying to teach alphabets or any course, the main reason here is that the partition of knowledge, imparting knowledge is the same. So if it is the same, why are we questioning a reduction in fee when there is no change in impartation of knowledge? And the learning is the same, everything is the same. So there shouldn't be a reduction in fee. Thereby, Judicious Jaguars firmly believe that educational institutions should not reduce their fees for online classes and have provided the audience and the opponents with strong arguments to believe the same. Thank you, and over to you.
Thank you, TM Alina. 45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Timer, please note. Thank you, timer. Moving on, I would like to call upon the rebuttal speaker from Team Negative, TM Sanaya Parker.
Good evening to Toastmasters, guests, and our worthy opponents. Fees for online classes should be reduced for educational institutions. Our team, Judicious Jaguars, prominently stands against it, and we shall prove why using each of the points our worthy opponents have mentioned. First, law in Philippines. My worthy opponents believe that the law in Philippines have stated, justifies their stand. But my team has found various other laws that prove their stand otherwise. KHDA in Dubai says that schools should not reduce their fees, while ADEK of Abu Dhabi supports that they should increase them instead. UK government also insists on not reducing their institute fees. And this is coming from the major hubs of education, that is UK and US. Second, the mentions of Supreme Court of India. I'm sorry, my worthy opponents. This piece of information is slightly outdated. Recently, a bill of reduction of fees was given to the Indian Supreme Court, and that bill was rejected. This news was popular in various newspapers like Times of India and The Hindu on the 7th May onwards. Do you know why? Because they said those fees are considered as commercial fees. And because not only the institutes will have to follow them, but also every other company possible. Now, do my dear opponents mean that they're saying that salary cuts for all freelancers should be justified only because the products and the services are making less money, or because they're not working enough? Because that's what my opponents are throwing on the institute's face. Last but not the least, extra costs from customers like phones and computers. We live in the 21st century, and I can guarantee that almost all households have a smartphone as well as a laptop. And in fact, statistics from census.gov say that 78% of households have a laptop or a computer, while 76% of them have a phone. In fact, they're considered as a part of today's necessities. Are you telling me that you blame the institutions for not paying for the extra expense that you're having while they're already providing licenses like Microsoft Teams, Zoom Pro, and Grammarly? Isn't this blatant stupidity? Institutes are already trying their best to make sure that their students are comfortable and they get their valued knowledge. They're even giving overtime. Aren't my worthy opponents being a little mean and expecting a whole arm while they're just getting a finger to grasp? Therefore, I repeat our team's stand. We judicious Jaguars are against the topic. Fees for online classes should be reduced, should not be reduced for educational institutions. Over to you.
Thank you, TM Sonaya. Timer, please note, 45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Thank you, timer. Let's move on. The next rebuttal speaker from Team Affirmative, TM Tina Satish.
Good morning, everyone. And a warm thank you and hello to my opposing speakers. So first and foremost, she pointed out in her definition of online, the payment that we do is for the learning spaces. Now, let me ask from you, on an online platform, what is the space where you're sitting? So why are we paying extra for this space of me sitting here in my pajamas or my slippers? What about the extra cost that comes that the college would have incurred in case of other extracurricular activities or labs or so forth, which as an online student, I am not availing of? Why should I pay that extra amount? No one is saying we have to completely waive off the tuition fees. We just want a reduction for the facilities that are being left unused by the so-called online students as compared to the campus, on-campus students. She mentioned that the quality is the same. I would like to understand exactly how would you define quality of this education, where there is sort of a lot of limitations when it comes to having a more of an online education. Forbes says that no matter how stricken the university finances are or however hard the staff might work, the onus of paying the increased fees does not lie on the student. So as a team, I think we propose that it should not be the students that have to be paying the extra amount that comes when it comes, or paying the extra when it comes to online fees, but they should have certain other facilities wherein the government can provide grants or so forth. As Thoreau says, the price of anything is the amount of life that you exchange for it. There is an online study by Medline and so forth saying that screen time should be reduced to 3 to 4, whereas physical education is extended to at least 7 hours. Why are we paying extra for that 4 hours that they've specifically said is harmful for a person who's doing online education? So the amount of life that I as an online student would be much less than the 7 hours that I spend on campus. So why should I pay that extra amount that is being delayed on us in terms of the fees that is equivalent to the physical and also the online education? Any education, of course, no one could put a price on education, but in the end of the day, education is definitely an investment. And as any investment goes, we want to make sure that we are getting the most value out of the least amount of investment that we can put in. And this is what we also require when it comes to an online education, wherein everything is on the minimal basis in terms of an on-campus education. So as a team, we do stand for the statement that fees for online classes must be reduced by the education institutions. Thank you.
Thank you, TM Tina. Let's take the 45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Timer, please note. Thank you, timer. Let's move on to the final set of speakers for PR4. I would like to call upon the summary speaker from Team Negative, TM Akshara Suresh.
Good morning, everyone, and a special good morning to our worthy opponents. Team Judicious Jaguar speaks against the motion. Fees for online courses should be reduced by educational institutions. My opening and rebuttal speaker gave powerful arguments on why fees for online courses should not be reduced. I'm here to reiterate some of the points mentioned by my fellow teammates. There is no difference in the quality of education. In fact, my opening speaker provided strong statistics to back this argument from Forbes 2020 and Insider Ed, which clearly shows online education is growing and there is continuous improvement in the quality. In her second point, she has proved online education has existed from a very long time using a research from US Department of Education. Further, she provided great examples that show that the price of the fee is based on the knowledge imparted. There should not be a change in the fees. Moving on to my rebuttal speaker, who brilliantly rebutted the arguments of our worthy opponents, where she proved various articles and researchers globally. She also stressed on the fact that phone and a laptop is a necessity for today's world. My opening and rebuttal speaker have provided strong arguments against the motion, and we firmly hold our ground that fees for online courses should not be reduced, as it is a necessity to maintain the fees of online classes. I would like to conclude that Judicious Jaguar strongly stands against the motion that states fees for online courses should be reduced by educational institutions. And with that, I rest my case. Thank you.
Thank you, TM Akshara. Let's have the 45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Timers, please note. Thank you, Timer. Moving on to the final speaker of PR4, let me call upon summary speaker from Team Affirmative, TM Manpreet Kaur.
Good morning, fellow Toastmasters. We, as a team, stand in favor of the motion, fees for online classes must be reduced by educational institutions. The multitude of points mentioned by our respected opponent team has put forward were mostly to make our stand strong. The fees that we have to pay is not just for the education, but also for the lab and other facilities. My teammates clearly slammed the opponent team's points by stating the facts and figures. July 31, 2020, Philippine Senator Maria stated that schools should not be playing blind and profiting on what they would no longer provide. Parents and students should definitely be paying less. Forbes article on 6 November 2020 wonderfully highlighted this point, that however stricken university finances are and however university staff have been working, it is not for the students to bail them out. In May 2021, Supreme Court of India said that demanding fees, even in respect of overheads, would be nothing short of indulging in profiteering and commercialization. In March 2021, the University of Seattle announced that except for tuition fees, it will suspend other recreational fees, graduate activity fees, and other additional fees. In the publication, The Future of Online Learning by Ashley Murphy, the prices for online learning course for comparable on-campus degrees costed around 50% less in the regions US and UK. If the educational institutions in all those countries have lowered fees for online courses, why can't others do the same? And by the way, I don't have deep pockets to pay for the facilities I don't even get to use. So yes, I do want reduction in fees for the online classes. It's not about the quality of education, but about what we utilize. It's only fair to pay for what we use. So we as team stand in favor of the motion.
Thank you, TM Manpreet. Let's take the 3 minutes for the judges to mark the ballots. Timer, please note. May I request Zoom Master to please share the participation certificates? Thank you, Zoom Master. Contestants of PR4, get your cameras on, flash that smile, and requesting Zoom Master to click that wonderful group picture.
Thank you.
Thank you, Zoom Master. Thank you, contestants. With that, we have come to the end of the fourth preliminary round debate between the invincible icons and the judicious jaguars. Let us all give both the teams a good round of applause. After four rounds of intense verbal battling and debating, I think it's time for all of us to take that 10 minutes break and grab a cup of coffee. Do return for another set of scintillating debates after the break. You all have been a wonderful audience and the contestants have been equally wonderful. So let's all gather around for the next set of debates. Thank you.
to the Interdivision Debate Contest 2020-2021. I'm sure you all are like me, are yearning for yet another session of debate. I know these sessions are contagious. Like the Lay's chips, you can't just have one. Keeping everyone's interest in mind, here we have another set of debaters to showcase and enhance their debating skills. To take this session forward, we have our next moderator for the day, who is a person with a high profile. Here it goes, a civil engineer, a project management professional, an MBA, and the most important, a passionate Toastmaster since 4 years. And he belongs to TGIS and SP Jain Toastmasters Club. He has been a participant in several debate contests and has bagged best rebuttal and won the Area 48 Debate Contest 2020. Not only that, he also won as the runner-up for the Division L Debate Contest, Verbal Rumble 2020. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Toastmaster Khalijan Abdul Wahid to carry on the interesting session forward. The virtual stage is yours, Toastmaster Khalijan.
Thank you so much. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the second half of the preliminary round of District 105 Inter-Division Debate Contest. And it is my pleasure to be the debate moderator for the last three rounds of this contest. Debating is not just about competition. It supplements us with real life skills. Personally, participating in several Toastmasters debate contests has helped me immensely. The preparation process itself is so invigorating. Most importantly, I have enjoyed the teamwork involved in the preparation. It is that teamwork that guides us eventually to a cohesive line of thought. Before we kick off, I would like to once again thank all those who have given me this wonderful opportunity. Today, we will be experiencing how the teams lined up are going to define terms, list out their arguments, support their views, state interpretations, redefine definitions, rebut, defend, and conclude. Let us now begin the battle. The Inter-Division Debate Contest 2020-21. At the outset, let me state the debate rules in brief. If a team does not report at the commencement of the contest, a walkover will be provided to the opposition team present, and they automatically move to the next round. If both the teams in a group are not present at the time of commencement, that group shall be eliminated from participation. No speaker shall take the opportunity of abusing or accusing an opponent personally during his address. In case of technical failure, our chief judge will intervene and stop the speaker. 1 minute shall be given for the participant to reconnect. The speaker shall continue from where they ended the speech at the time of the technical failure. The speaker will be given the remaining time to complete the speech along with 30 seconds grace time. In case the speaker is unable to reconnect, then the backup speaker is to take over immediately. Even if more than one speaker of a team faces any kind of a technical issue, only the same backup speaker will be permitted to replace the speakers. The sequence of the speaking is as shown in this slide. Timer, please note. timing for the opening speaker and rebuttal speaker. Green light at 2.5 minutes. Red light at 3 minutes. For the closing speaker, green light at 1.5 minutes. Red light at 2 minutes. 45 seconds between speakers for judges to mark the ballot. 3 minutes at the end of the debate for judges to tally the scores. Our chief judge this afternoon is DTM Ramesh Anandaraman. It is now time to begin the contest. Zoom master, are we ready? Timers, are you ready?
Yes.
Now, for the fifth preliminary round debate, please welcome our two teams, Team Dynamic Daredevils for the motion and Team Fiery Fighters against the motion. As I call upon each contestant, please say, I'm ready for the battle. Representing Team Dynamic Daredevils are opening speaker, Toastmaster Sam Cherian.
I'm ready for the battle.
Wonderful. Rebuttal speaker, Toastmaster R. Ramanujan.
I am ready for the battle.
Closing speaker, Toastmaster Rajiv Vakayal.
I too ready for the battle.
Backup speaker, Toastmaster Suresh Karta. Going against them is the team Fiery Fighters, represented by opening speaker, Toastmaster Snigdha Pandey.
I'm ready for the battle.
Rebuttal speaker, Toastmaster Rupa Prabhu Krishnan.
I'm ready for the battle.
Closing speaker, Toastmaster Radhika Annam Raju.
I'm ready for the battle.
Backup speaker, Toastmaster Lini Panika.
I'm ready for the battle.
Chief Judge, do I have your permission to proceed?
Please proceed. All the very best.
Thank you. The motion for the debate is citizens who do not vote should be fined. Citizens who do not vote should be fined. Now, I would like to call the first speaker from Team Affirmative for opening, Toastmaster Sam Cherian.
Debate moderator, my worthy opponents, good morning. The motion on the floor is citizens who do not vote should be fined, and my team firmly stands for the motion. A democracy is a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. What then is the citizen voting for? Food in his plate, a family to gather around, social security, financial stability, a life of dignity, all fruits of good governance. HBR classifies Australia as an innovator in democracy and voting. It is one of the first nations to establish compulsory voting fines for not voting. In this regard, The Guardian in 2016 recorded President Barack Obama's praise for Australia's 91% voter turnout in their elections. Currently, compulsory voting laws exist in 30 countries across the world. 10 of them enforce the mandate to vote and punish abstainers who do not with a fine. This is not a new initiative, but one that's gaining ground and relevance. In Belgium, the practice of voting and fines date back right to the 19th century. Our effort this morning will accelerate that pace. The OECD country report, of which India is the 27th member, released a set of data of 306 parliamentary elections for 32 years from 1982 to 2012. This report establishes a strong correlation between compulsory voting, better turnout, and thereby healthier governance index. Predictably, Australia and Belgium figure very high in the list. Okay. Voting is important, I understand, but why fine them if they don't vote? The freedom to vote has been hard won across the world in every society, and each of us have stories of our own. However, the world Economic Forum report of 2018 records only 5 countries with more than 75% voter turnout. Belgium, Sweden, Denmark, Australia, South Korea. If franchise is so hard gained, where then is the half of the population? Where then is the third of the population? In a country like India, where I'm from, with 911 million voters, 300 million did not vote last time. That's 33%. The British Psychological Society paper in 2018 nails the reason for this behavior. I simply do not care for this vote. One, the diffusion of responsibility. It is not my responsibility to vote. Second, I do not do it, somebody else will. Third, what if I get it wrong? Members of the House and my worthy opponents, the next time you hear slim majority, average turnout to do with voting, you do realize the possibilities. Our team submits that voting is merely not a right or a privilege, but definitely a compulsory civic duty and responsibility that you must be fined for if you don't adhere. Over to you, debate moderator.
45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Now, I would like to call the constructive speaker from Team Negative, Toastmaster Snigdha Pandey.
Good morning, debate moderator, members of the House, and our esteemed judges. We, the Fighty Fighters, are against the motion that citizens who do not vote should be fined, because this violation of rights has social challenges, infrastructural challenges, and is simply ineffective. Turkey, Sweden, Denmark, South Korea, as per the 2020 report by the International Institute for Democracy and Electoral Assistance, these countries had the highest voter turnout in 2020. And guess what? None of them have compulsory voting. You know why? Because instead of encroaching upon the rights of their citizens, they decided to do something that actually works: scaling up special voting arrangements and creating awareness. Let's talk about the social challenges. Australia, for example. Anecdotal evidence suggests that the election workers there, they found blank ballots with pencil artwork drawn on them. It may not be a pencil artwork, it may just be a blank ballot, or it may be randomly pressed buttons on an EVM. The point is, it's a misrepresentation of the voter turnout and is ineffective. Infrastructural challenges are the most pressing, especially in developing countries. For example, in 2018, there was a report by the African Development Bank that stated that 80% of the continent's countries have an infrastructure development index of less than 30. Now, at that rate of infrastructure development, how long do you think will it take to create a new infrastructure for elections? And is it even worth to spend so much money on it? In the absence of infrastructure, such a rule is going to fail and create a new path for corruption. Because believe it or not, as per the UN report in 2019, 690 million people in the world went to bed hungry. Is it human to levy fines on them? And how exactly do you expect them to pay for these fines? So it's not going to work. But we do have a counter suggestion. Instead of having this rule, try something that has actually worked. Try educating your citizens on the impact of their votes and generate awareness. Because we believe that awareness is the key, not levying fines. And with this, we urge the House to reject this motion that citizens who do not vote should be fined. Over to you, debate moderator.
45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Now, I would like to call the rebuttal speaker from Team Negative, Toastmaster Rupa Prabhu Krishnan.
Most honorable judges, revered moderator, and simple citizens like me, along with the able, worthy opponents, a very bright, sunny morning to all of you. You know what, I was a little confused when the opening speaker started because I was not sure if the speaker was speaking for the motion or against the motion because he was bringing in a lot of points against the motion favoring us. Let me start with the very first point about the democracy of the country, for the people, by the people. What a nice statement to start with, thereby leading me to the context of freedom of speech. How many of you have heard that? It is essentially a Compelled Speech Act, which violates freedom of speech because the freedom to speak necessarily also includes freedom not to speak. Thus, it is a civil right that is given to me, which I choose to exercise or choose not to exercise. Some countries also give the option of none of the above options for the candidates. Why go all the way and choose that option, isn't it? So freedom of not to vote is again my right as well. Why should you fine me for using that right appropriately? The second point, you spoke about all the developed countries like USA, Australia, Brazil, having in the mandatory laws. You're speaking of minority of countries having the mandatory laws, my dear worthy opponent. What about those countries, like my opening speaker spoke about, doesn't have the infrastructure? How will they manage? Will they work for their bread and butter, or will they work towards paying the fine for not voting? Yes, you spoke about the governance. The governance of the country should take care of the basic requirements and not fringe benefits like this for fines collected by non-voting citizens. That's not mandatory at this point of time at all. I have an interesting fact. You spoke about Australia, didn't you? And you spoke about Belgium. Well, here is another fact that adds to your misery, I would say. Compulsory voting is increasingly resented by citizens in some countries such as Brazil, which is one of the largest countries where compulsory voting is enforced. And at the 2014 presidential election, 30 million people resented voting, despite the fact that Brazil has some of the severe penalties. And you know what? You listed all the countries which has mandatory voting, but some of the mandatory voting countries do not even enforce the laws or they enforce the penalties on the citizens. So why mandate such a law? India, 300 million didn't vote. Yes, 300 million didn't vote. But what is the purpose of voting? To find and choose their leader. That purpose was met, wasn't it? Without fining the citizens for non-voting. Well, if the purpose was met, with even a minor percentage of people voting, which is electing the leader, why mandate fines? Hence, me and my team strongly urge against the motion, citizens who do not vote.
1 second for the judges to mark the ballot. now, I would like to call the rebuttal speaker from Team Affirmative, Toastmaster R. Ramanujan.
Respected debate moderators and my fellow worthy opponents, first of all, thanks for the great emotional speech that you have given to give your points that citizens who do not vote should not be fined. First of all, you spoke about violation of rights. Where we are telling you that it's not violation of rights. Even your nota option, which was introduced recently, gave the right to reject. We are just asking you to come and vote. So it is not a violation of rights. It is a right which is being given under the constitution of the various countries where you just need to exercise, whether yes or no. Even abstain or not giving a comment on anything is very simple that you are participating. Second, you told about the countries of Sweden, Turkey, South Korea, highest voter turnaround, and they don't have a compulsory voting. But I would like you to go on the study in the OECD countries where voter turnaround is dependent on many factors. There are two things on institutional variables like presence of PR system, presence of compulsory voting, generator, the number of party peoples who are going for the elections, then simultaneous elections happens. These all have a factors of voter turnaround. Similarly, there are also socioeconomic variables like population size, high level of GDP, high level of unemployment, urban employment, elderly people. So all these factors design voter turnaround, and it's not just a compulsory voting. A compulsory voting paves the way for the citizens to come and participate in this democratic thing. The third thing you told about Australia, pencil artworks, random misrepresentation. Very simple. If the election is being decided only on the random thing, okay, fine. Then I'm sorry, because you will counterattack with your point, there should be awareness. When there's an awareness, oh, there will be a misrepresentation. Even in the school, we are studying about the elections in college, but if you see the recent 2020 elections, US election, I'm quoting US because it's one of the highest democratic country, where around 43% of the people who didn't vote have told that I don't have time. I have prior appointments. This is a silly thing which I don't like to participate. These people are high school graduates and postgraduate people. Now you see where is the awareness. You have done the awareness. You know how much of funds you have been pumped for each elections, and the funds is not people, it's your money, my money, and you want the system to go every year pumping funds for election and not bringing a system of a compulsory voting. Then the last thing you went about the counter suggestion. Remember, please come to the topic. Don't deviate. We are not asking you a counter suggestion. We are asking whether it should be fined or not. If you have the right, it comes with responsibility. If you are going and striking between the government through hartals and everything, why should not government strike you? Why should not government fine you when you don't even do the basic right of a civic responsibility? So all your facts are baseless and all your arguments are not coming to that topic and is just deviating with the counter suggestion. Rest my case that citizens who do not vote should be fined.
45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. No. Now, I would like to call the summary speaker from Team Negative, Toastmaster Radhika Annamraju.
A very good morning to the debate moderator, my worthy opponents, and members of the audience. We firmly oppose the motion, citizens who do not vote should be fined. Our opening speaker has supported this argument by her stance that this is a violation of right, which has social and infrastructural challenges, and also it is in a sense. Further, she has supported the argument by her three main arguments,
In 2020, the countries having the highest turnout of voters did not have fines for people who do not vote. And in a country like Australia, which has compulsory voting, many of the votes lodged were blank votes or random votes, which show that it is ineffective. And many countries have very poor infrastructure, and how feasible and practical it is for them to invest the time and resources for developing special infrastructure for voting. Now, if there were any doubts left, it was all cleared when my second speaker clearly quashed the argument of the affirmative team when she mentioned that freedom of right of an individual, freedom of speech of include freedom not to speak. And developed countries are not benchmarks for most of the countries, as they are only a few minor countries. And then she also mentioned with evidence that places where voting is compulsory and there are fines, people resent voting. All in all, we say that there are better measures like better arrangements and creating more voter awareness, which can make the voting system effective rather than imposing fines. So we firmly urge this House to reject the motion that citizens who do not vote should be fined. Over to your debate moderator.
45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Before I call the next speaker, I would request everyone else to please mute their audios. We do not want disturbance from anyone else. Please make this sure. Now, I would like to call the summary speaker from Team Toastmaster Rajiv Vakil.
Debate masters, fellow Toastmasters, and our worthy opponent, good morning. The ignorance of one voter in democracy impairs the security of all, said John F. Kennedy. Let me summarize. My opening speaker has clearly introduced the debate topic. He straight away established why we as a responsible citizen should vote for a good governance in the country, for our safety and security, for our better future. My speaker has presented three clear evidence to support our topic. Number one, the Harvard University Journal related to voters turnout. Number two, a detailed 30-year statistics released by OCC data, which establishing the strong correlation between a compulsory voting, better turnout, and thereby healthier governance. Number three, a report released by British Psychological Society in 2017 June, mentioning the low voting turnout caused by the behavioral attitude and thereby showing the importance of imposing fine for no voting. With these facts and statistics and logic, my opening speaker has proven and demonstrated that citizens should be fined for not voting. My rebuttal speaker has emphatically rebutted the opposition by facts and figures, such as supporting the rights of the citizen, number two, the OCCD data, and the other social variable influencing the voting. He reiterated the behavior of citizens for not voting and the need of imposing for sign for saving your and my hard-earned money. These facts and figures conclusively support our motion that who do not vote should be fined. Therefore, we strongly propose that the citizen who do not vote should be fined. Over to you, debate master.
3 minutes for the judges to mark the ballot. I request all contestants of preliminary round 6 to put on their videos. Zoom master, please share the participation certificates. Zoom master, could you please take a group picture of all the contestants? May I request all the contestants of preliminary round 6 to put on their videos, please?
It's done. Thank you. With that, we come to the end of the 5th preliminary round debate between the dynamic daredevils and the fiery fighters. Let us give them both a big round of applause. It is now time to begin the next contest. Zoom Master, are we ready? Timers. Are you ready?
Yes, we are, moderator.
Moving on to the 6th debate in the preliminary rounds. We have the eloquent eagles pitted against the heroic hawks. As I call upon each contestant, please say, I am ready for the battle. Speaking for the motion are the eloquent Eagles, represented by opening speaker, Toastmaster Elamparthi Selvarasu.
Yeah, I'm ready for the battle.
Rebuttal speaker, Toastmaster Mandar Medhi.
Hi, I'm ready for the battle.
Closing speaker, Toastmaster Varun Kumar K.
Good morning, debate moderator, and I am ready for the battle.
Backup speaker, Toastmaster Agnik Bose.
Good morning, debate moderator. I'm ready for the battle.
Wonderful. Speaking against the motion are the heroic hawks, represented by opening speaker, Toastmaster Dayan Silva.
Good morning. I am ready for the battle.
Rebuttal speaker, Toastmaster Alok Tateja.
Good morning, debate moderator. I am charged for the battle.
Closing speaker, Toastmaster Anand Natarajan.
Good morning, debate moderator. I'm ready to win the battle.
Backup speaker, Toastmaster Ruslan Harrison. Chief Judge, do I have your permission to proceed?
Please go ahead. All the very best.
Thank you. The motion for this debate is work from home has increased productivity. Work from home has increased productivity. Now, I would like to call the first speaker from Team Affirmative for opening. Toastmaster Elamparuthi Selvarasu.
Does work from home work? Moderator and fellow Toastmasters,
if you think I am asking you a question, you are mistaken. That is the title of the research paper published by the university in 2015. And the research actually was conducted in 2011 back in China. And the research findings clearly suggest that the average income, the performance of the employees went up by 9% in comparison with the office-bound employees. The performance not only increased by 9%, it also gave a lot of other benefits to the company. For example, productivity is measured against the output versus input, which also includes labor and capital. The company could save around $2,000 per year per work from home employee. Moreover, the work from home employee could also save around $230. Surprisingly, attrition rate fell by 50%. Even the company did not expect this. It was a lottery for them. This is no surprise because Global Workplace Analytics estimated that an average employer would save around $11,000 per employee per year, even if he works only half-time work from home. And the employee would save around $2,000 to $4,000 per annum. So it is quite clear that it is a win-win situation for both the employer and the employee. Then a report published by the Center for Economic Policy Research in UK in 2020 categorically asserted that work from home has increased productivity as it has offset the negative impacts created by the pandemic on productivity. To add to it, another report published in 2020 by the University of Southampton titled Working from Home Under COVID-19 Lockdown, Transitions and Tensions, say that 88% of the employees felt that their productivity went up. Now, if you look at the data closely, the picture becomes clearer. That is, 32% of the employees felt that their productivity went a lot more. 22 felt that their productivity went a bit more, and 34 said that it was the same. As a whole, the productivity of the employees, 54% of them felt that their productivity went up more. So put all these things together, it is abundantly clear that work from home has increased productivity. Back to you, moderator.
45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Now, I would like to call the constructive speaker from Team Negative, Toastmaster Dayan Silva.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development has defined productivity as a quantitative tool that measures total amount of output by an employee divided by the amount of hours worked. Let us examine whether working from home is indeed more productive. Please be mindful that the burden of proof is for my affirmative to prove without a shadow of a doubt that working from home brings more productivity for the organization. In the current pandemic environment, majority of us were forced to work from home. But work from home was possible even before the pandemic. Why didn't companies allow employees to work from home? In fact, in 2013, Yahoo, which was one of the top 50 best places to work by Business Insider, completely banned working from home. Reason? They cited, I quote, speed and quality are often sacrificed when we work from home. So it is very clear that working from home has been introduced as a fallback strategy for businesses and not a long-term solution for the future. One of the main sectors who were ready to move to work from home structure as the pandemic hit was the IT sector. In a research done by University of Chicago on IT sector this May, indicates that employees significantly increased total hours worked to give the same output by 30%. Employees continued to meet their existing goals and there were no motivation to deliver more. Looking back at the initial formula of productivity, we can see that working more hours only will result in reduction in productivity. Forbes magazine on August 20 said that job satisfaction, job motivation has fallen drastically. Job satisfaction from 57 to 32%. Job motivation from 56% to 36%. And we all know when motivation to work goes down, productivity will go down. Following which, Forbes magazine in January this year stated people have worked hard initially, but subsequently faced a significant dip in productivity. So, what improves productivity? Journal of Business Economics and Finance suggests 9 factors important to improve productivity are as follows: goal setting, performance feedback, role congruity, defined processes, workplace incentives, supervisor support, mentoring and coaching, opportunity to apply, and job aids. Among 9 things I've listed, not a single one suggests or supports by working from home. In summary, it has been proven that people are working far more hours to achieve the same amount of productivity as the status quo. Job satisfaction and job motivation has fallen, which in turn productivity has fallen. Indeed, to improve productivity, work from home has no part to play. In face of all these facts, we the opposition has led to you, we believe it's not.
Seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Now, I would like to call the rebuttal speaker from Team Negative, Toastmaster Alok Tateja.
Debate Master, Chief Judge, and eminent panel of judges, and my worthy opponent. Good morning to you all. What I observed in the opening of my opponent, he quoted, few references from the research which were done by any university and in a other country of not a corporate, a general research. Now, if you want to measure a productivity of organization, you go to an organization, quote the organization's name, and then you measure the productivity. Research are done for a purposes, and we know why they have done. And why a US university has not done research in the US, why they do it in China where data is not verifiable. That shows the intent of that research which he quoted. Now, coming back to my data to support and to say that work from home has not increased productivity or productivity has not increased. First and foremost thing is, there is a tool called Sapien Analytics, which started in 2007. And this tool is there to measure productivity in your laptops or in electronic gadgets. And this tool could not be sold before pandemic, but within last year, it was sold over $48 million and 1 trillion users. That means a company which have a concern or productivity of, they are not positive about the productivity of remote working. Now I'll cite a few more things to countermeasure the my opponent's opinion. In this forum, today we have four speakers. If we would have in physical contest, we would have three. We were more efficient. Today we are not. We need four for three. That's the online and work from environment. HCL Technologies, who use the Sapien tool, quoted in their annual report that 30% productivity reduced this year because of working online. They have been fined by their client for not doing their employee job for $2 million, they quoted in their annual report. 7 out of 10 SEC top companies, 8 out of 10 companies listed in stock exchange in India has quoted this year's their enterprise risk as productivity loss due to pandemic or work from home. And they cited the reason what employees quote, electricity gone for 2 hours, not coming for meeting, and having a poor internet connection for not hearing. So tools need to work for a new meetings are we depend upon them, like our backup speaker today we need. So definitely productivity had reduced, proven in our contest also, we need 2 backup devices, not 1. Now coming back to, people hire psychologists, companies hire psychologists to support the employees' well-being while working from home.
...45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Now, I would like to call the rebuttal speaker from Team Affirmative, Toastmaster Mandar Medhi.
Debate moderator, respected judges, fellow Toastmasters, guests, and my worthy opponents, good morning to all of you. My opponent opening speaker started his speech by citing the definition of productivity from the OECD, Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development, where he stated that productivity is equal to output upon number of hours put in. Now, my friend here was trying to cite the definition of output as number of hours. That is, he was going to go in for a tangible quantification, which is not correct. The definition of productivity, to be just information for all, is output upon input, and input means all the factors that go into the manufacturing or into the output of any product or services, which is man, machine, money, materials, and management. So it's a gamut of all the factors. Secondly, he cited the example of 2013 Yahoo, which completely banned for the speed and for the quality of all the offline meetings. And they insisted that they come in work in offices. But my friend, this is a very old data of 8 years back, which you are citing. Do you know that recently in July 2020, when the pandemic struck, the USA was, you know, panic stricken, and they have again called back for the work from home, that is offline, you know, working online and not in the offices per se, physically present. To cite the example and to support this, we are talking about Yahoo. I would give example of Tata Consultancy Services, TCS in India. The moment it strike, from that day onwards, they started 50% work from home, which has really made increased productivity. And now they have declared recently, 6 months back, January 2021, 90% of staff, not only TCS, other IT companies, major IT companies in India, worldwide, they are going to go for work from home, which has definitely brought in from the conclusions and findings that work from home definitely has increased productivity. My wise opponent, friend, mentioned about Forbes magazine. He cited about August 2020 examples of 57 coming down to 32 productivity, 56% coming down to 36% motivation. But these are all, you know, generic. These are all generic and only related to certain segment and strata of the population. It doesn't represent the worldwide figures of the entire population, my dear friend. Lastly, he also mentioned about Journal of Economics and Finance, 9 factors which were against working from home. But I would not cite you 10 factors which are in favor of working from home. Time saving on commuting, then your fatigue and both physical and mental reduces. 2018 data of USA says that commuting time has reduced by 30 minutes, thereby 15 days of year you can invest somewhere. Then you can also create your own mini commute around your house by walking, thereby, okay, improving your work-life balance. Distractions go down to a large extent. Remote workers produce more when it comes to the meetings, especially now we are in a Zoom meeting, MS Teams meeting. Leads to more comfortable life, cost saving for both employers and employee. And lastly, technology tools, tips, tricks are available. So I request how...
45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Now, I would like to call the summary speaker from Team Negative, Toastmaster Anand Nadrajan.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. What we have witnessed today is the building of a strong case against today's motion, as our honorable opposition was not able to prove that work from home increases productivity. Our team has systematically and with ease proven that this is not the case. We have gone far to prove that productivity can even decrease as a result of working from home. Our opening speaker brilliantly proved with irrefutable factual evidence that not only suggests, but even states clearly that work from home practices can be detrimental to productivity. Productivity, which again has been aptly defined as an employee's output divided by the number of hours by the OECD. The University of Chicago research we allude to was published last month and is recent, hence including any effects of the pandemic. It proves that IT firms, which are deemed the best to handle with such crisis, are not able to handle it in reality, seeing a 30% decline. We support this hypothesis from evidence from reputed international publications such as Forbes and the Journal of Business Economics and Finance, enhancing the credibility of this argument. Despite what can only be called a feeble attempt of a rebuttal, our opening speaker's arguments still remain valid due to their sheer volume and unanimity. Our rebuttal speaker started off by neutralizing the very base of our honorable opponent's arguments, which was based on an obvious fallacy. Let me remind you that the burden of proof in this case rests with our opposition, and they haven't been able to prove, without a smidgen of doubt, that work from home increases productivity. If anything, their words reiterate and reinforce our conviction against today's motion, and we urge you all to vote against today's motion. Over to you.
45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Now, I would like to call the summary speaker from Team Affirmative, Toastmaster Varun Kumar K.
Respected debate moderator and judges, a very good morning. Resolved, work from home has increased productivity. Let me count the ways our team has articulated this point. Now, let me address also the elephant in the room. We are talking about COVID here. So our research presented by our team states categorically that pre-COVID and post-COVID, the writing is very clear on the wall in terms of productivity. Stanford University research conducted in 2011, published in 2015, way before the pandemic, indicated that work from home was beneficial to both employer as well as employee. Performance of employees thanks to work from home, remote working increased by 9%. Companies saved over $2,000 per individual per annum. And the individuals themselves saved $230 at least. Attrition rate fell by 50%. If this doesn't mean productivity, please explain it to me. Global Workplace Analytics estimated that a savings of $11,000 per year for full-time workers and $2,000 to $5,000 for part-time workers. If this doesn't explain productivity, please explain it to me. A report published in 2020 by the Center of Economic Policy Research in the UK categorically stated that the work from home has increased productivity as it has offset the negativity of the pandemic. University of Southampton confirmed that 88% of employees confirmed that they felt good and felt that they were more productive as pre-pandemic before. From the points of our forwarded by our rebuttal speaker, Toastmaster Mandar, it is important to note that thanks to work from home, 90% of IT companies have moved their employees onto the work from home platform. And let's not forget the work from home protocols right now allow us as employees to even talk about the word work home balance. And that work-life balance has only done what? Increased our productivity. And to give also a chance for employees to improve their skills. Through all this, ladies and gentlemen, let's just smell the coffee and wake up. It is resolved that work from home does increase productivity. Over to you, debate moderator.
3 minutes for the judges to mark the ballot. Zoom master, please share the participation certificates. Requesting all contestants from preliminary round 7 to be ready with your videos. Zoom master, could you please take a group picture of all the contestants?
Thank you.
Wonderful. May I request all the contestants of preliminary round 7 to put on their videos, please? With that, we come to the end of the 6th preliminary round debate between the Eloquent Eagles and the Heroic Hawks. Let us give both the teams a big round of applause. It is now time to begin the next contest. Zoom Master, are we ready? Timers, are you ready?
Yes.
We are, Developed Moderator.
In the 7th preliminary round debate, where we have the gallant gladiators battling it out with the killer knights, as I call upon each contestant, please say, I am ready for the battle. Speaking for the motion are the gallant gladiators, represented by opening speaker, Toastmaster Anand Bhuraskar.
I am ready for the battle.
Rebuttal speaker, Toastmaster Kamini Singh.
I'm ready for the battle.
Closing speaker, Toastmaster Amit Luthra.
I am ready for the battle.
Backup speaker, Toastmaster Sandeep Malhotra.
I am ready for the battle.
Speaking against the motion are the Killer Knights, represented by opening speaker, Toastmaster Imtiaz Nizam.
I am ready for the battle.
Rebuttal speaker, Toastmaster Padmaja Dilip Kumar.
I'm ready for the battle.
Closing speaker, Toastmaster Priya Mohan.
Morning, moderator. I'm ready for the battle.
Backup speaker, Toastmaster Annamma Lucy.
I'm ready for the battle.
Chief Judge, do I have your permission to proceed?
Yes, you do have the permission. I'm requesting all the members of the audience to ensure they do not unmute their mics by mistake, please. Thank you.
Thank you. The motion for this debate is, schools should introduce monetary bonuses for students with the highest grades. Schools should introduce monetary bonuses for students with the highest grades. Now, I would like to call the first speaker from Team Affirmative for opening, Toastmaster Anand Bhuraskar.
Nobel laureate William Butler described education as not filling of a pail, but the lighting of a fire to learn sustainably. Good morning, all. The two key elements in the proposition are defined for a common reference. One, the monetary bonus means a cash payment made to someone over and above their standard compensation for a job well done. Number two, schools are the places where the future of the world is shaped today and includes law, business, and art schools, etc. Schools operate on the idea of rewarding hard work with good grades. But is that enough? Good grades do not necessarily convert to tangible rewards, which anyone is entitled into return for their hard work. Acknowledging the reality of life, the obvious answer is a firm yes. According to National Center for Education, students are at a school for an average of 7 hours every school day, and then spend several more hours studying at home while the average adult works 8 hours per work day. Bonus is like a bullet, a key, an often tiny object with astonishing power to change a situation, says renowned American economist Stephen Levitt. It is a known fact that adults perform better when a bonus is at stake. We all do so, don't we? Likewise, cash bonuses would encourage students and give them a tangible reward for their hard work. So why shouldn't we extend this policy in realm of schooling? Now we seek attention of the House to some core aspects in favor of the motion. Introducing monetary bonuses for the highest grades can keep kids and teens engaged with their studies while helping them to avoid the need to work and support themselves. Cash bonuses for highest grades encourages them to continue performing well in studies and making them recognize value of each penny earned. A 2016 study published in National Bureau of Economic Research, USA, found that the financial incentives improved students' academic performances to the tune of 25% to 30%. A 2018 report of Center for International Studies, Australia, shows that Al-Faisal School in Sydney improved its rank from 57 to 23 among the best schools by introducing monetary bonuses for students scoring highest grades. Benjamin Franklin said, "An investment in knowledge pays the best interest." It is time to make the investment by introducing monetary bonuses for students with highest grades. Over to you, Debate Master.
45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Now, I would like to call the constructive speaker from Team Negative, Toastmaster Imtiaz Nizam.
Thank you. Bonus, by definition, is conditional. Paying monetary bonuses to students for higher grades is similar to giving them steroids. A short-term reward can kill a student's love for the learning, their skills, and creativity in the long run. Good morning, the moderator, fellow Toastmasters, and my honorable opponents. We team Killer Knights strongly stand against the motion that schools should introduce monetary bonuses for students with higher grades. It is easy to get people to do things by paying them if you have got enough money and they have got the necessary skills, but they will keep doing it as long as you keep paying them. And even if they were doing it before, when you stop paying them, the behavior drops to a lower level than when you started paying them. This is called the overjustification effect. Dear friends, that A grade we pay dearly for actually does nothing to guarantee the future success we are banking on. Instead, school need to help students develop the skills they need to succeed now and down the road. A meta-analysis conducted by Daisy, Kosner, and Ryan in 1999 found that providing monetary bonuses can actually undermine students' intrinsic motivation, especially if students initially had a high interest in the task. In a classic experiment, they found that providing a cash bonus to young children to draw and color pictures resulted in a subsequent decrease in children's interest in drawing relative to children who had not received a reward. In a similar vein, Frey and Goyd found that high school volunteers who were collecting donations for charity put forth more effort when they were not compensated than when a small amount was paid. The experiment was again repeated in 2019 to check for variation, and interestingly, it only reinforced the findings of 1999, which clearly proves our argument against the motion. Andreas Glaser, an education expert at the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, says paying monetary bonuses for higher grades is going to divert the students in the wrong direction. If we cannot convince students of the relevance of what they learn and that economics and social benefits they derive from learning outweigh their cost, then there is something fundamentally wrong. Also, psychologists Bob Brooks and Goldstein says extrinsic motivations such as cash or clearly work against the continued development of a child. Intrinsic motivation, participating at school for the sheer pleasure of learning, is soon eclipsed by the promise of external rewards, and a child's natural enthusiasm for learning may be dampened. It doesn't really teach kids the reward of learning for learning's sake. Kids shouldn't be satisfied with the warm, fuzzy feeling of accomplishment. Is this possible when being paid for good grades? When paid for good grades, the students are no longer learning for a better future, but rather just for the reward of money. If the purpose of school is to educate, does the price of cash take that away? From students feeling not needed pressure to taking away the natural motivation to learn to not remembering the material presented, students should not be paid for good grades. My dear friends, let me ask you a question. Does the future belong to those who struggle to better themselves, make sacrifices and to do so and work hard, or to those who must be cajoled and bribed to learn anything at all? Ladies and gentlemen, I am very certain that our team has put the motion which we stand against, that schools should introduce monetary bonuses for students with higher grades. Back to you, the moderator.
45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Now, I would like to call the rebuttal speaker from Team Negative, Toastmaster Padmaja Dilip Kumar.
Monetary bonus is nothing but a form of control by seduction. Good morning, moderator, judges, and my dear worthy opponents. We, Killer Knights, strongly stand against the motion schools should introduce monetary bonuses for students with highest grades. My worthy opponent here said that cash payment made compensation for job well done. Well, student success on their terms is not something school should put a price on. A kind of motivation elicited by external factors like bonus erodes the internal motivation. We need to emphasize on the action, not the A. My dear friend, have you ever stopped to think what happens to the self-esteem of a student who has scored a lesser grade and their relationship with their peers, not to mention the psychological toll on students with learning disabilities who struggle with the easiest of tasks? It erodes the self-confidence, to say the least. My worthy opponent here provided research from Australia and USA showing a 35% increase in the ability of students. Well, paying for grades without helping students to cultivate life skills like dedication and accountability will only prepare them to rely on payouts. And let me provide you with a better stat, my friend. Finland education system ranks number one in the world. The students consistently are ranked high in program for international student assessment, an international benchmark for these exams, and they do not encourage monetary bonus. Finland is leading the way because of common sense practices and holistic teaching environment and strives for equity over bonuses for grades. A school alumni from 23 countries met in Helsinki, Finland, recently in 2020 to connect and share their projects. And one among them was our own UAE to emulate the exam structure. You spoke about the astonishing power of bonus because the adults, they have been given, and this should be extended to the realm of school because they work more than 7 hours. Well, first of all, you should know that there's a difference between monetary bonus, because monetary bonus for higher grades is nothing but a form of bribery. It is dehumanizing and a means of coercive control, which is destructive. It kills student creativity and undermines the risk-taking and breeds inequality. And talking about extending to school REAM, let me tell you, here's the bombshell for you. None other than the UNESCO's 2020 Global Education and Monitoring Report states that an estimated 258 million children are not in school. Schools introducing bonus only for higher grades could bring in a generational catastrophe that could undermine not only decades of progress, but also will deepen entrenched inequalities, especially in the wave of COVID-19 situation. And their tagline says it all, my friend, inclusion and education all means all. And you said good grades should be turned to tangible benefits. Well, let me ask you a question. What is the difference between a simile and metaphor? The correct answer is, who cares? Because the kids are highly interested in writing a story about dinosaurs or how a spaceship carries them away. These specific skills which we care about can be taught naturally without sugarcoating, without games, and above all, without offering kids doggy biscuits in the form of human bonus for what they are doing really want to do. So with that, we strongly stand against the motion, schools should introduce monetary bonuses for higher grades. Over to you, moderator.
45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Now I would like to call the rebuttal speaker from Team Affirmative, Toastmaster Kamini Singh.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much. So just to give you a glance, my friend, my dear opponent, monetary rewards are healthy for kids, you know, because the kids, they learn to prevail for the extra incentive and they must earn, my friend. I mean, what to say? I mean, you have used all stale data. Anyways, let me start with you. You said bonuses are steroid. Really? Are they steroid? That's what the whole world and the whole philosophy and everybody and all the psychologists are promoting it and following it. And then you said there is a guarantee. What is a guarantee? They will be using it. Let me tell you, the success isn't supposed to happen no matter what, how hard you work. There is no guarantee, my friend. You're going to succeed. There is no set in stone. Friend, there is no guarantee that when we spend billions of dollars on a Mars experiment or send a rover to the moon, that is there any guarantee it's going to be succeed? And you question the guarantee on spending little amount on this billion child. My friend, you did not understand that topic. It's given very clearly. It's very clear and crisp and a lovely topic to discuss today. Our topic today is schools should introduce monetary benefits for the students with highest grade. We're not talking about all the kids. We're talking about the giving monetary benefits to the kids with the highest grade, my friend. And you think that there is no guarantee? You want a guarantee for those kids? You are scared to spend money on those kids? No, my friend. No. You're absolutely wrong. And then what you said, data from 1999, many of you were not even born in that era, my friend. 1999, where we are living today. Do we even discuss that? No, I'm not even going to discuss that. It's an old data. And let's go to that classic experiment. What classic experiment, from where it came, it happened? Let me give you a classic experiment. Classic experiment happened in 2004, which is running today in Ohio, Cohagen City, where Dr. Eric from Stanford University took this experiment and started paying monetary benefits, $100 for the kids doing well in their studies. And the result, it's a small town. Kaushigan City is a very small town. And there was nothing. The school was not doing very well. And the result was students were going there. The result was amazing. We are looking here now. And then you're talking about bribe. Heavily pregnant word, my friend. Bribe. It's a crime. It's a criminal word to use. You can't use a word bribe for a reward. We're talking about reward here. I mean, you have no point, my friend. Unfortunately, you couldn't bring out any data or any research. And my friend Anand has already put a lot of research in this data. I mean, there is nothing even, I don't see good to rebut. Data from 2019 you've got wrong direction. You use the bribe word. I rest my case. It should move in our motion. Thank you so much.
45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Now, I would like to call the summary speaker from Team Negative, Toastmaster Priya Mohan.
Good morning, moderator, fellow Toastmasters, and my honorable opponents. My team, Killer Knights, stand against the motion that schools should introduce monetary bonuses for students with higher grades. Our opening speaker started his argument with the fact that incentivizing the students with the short-term rewards like monetary benefits is like giving them steroids. He questioned the very real fundamental stand with the point that when you stop paying them or bribing them, the behavior drops to a lower level than when you started paying them and can end in an over-justification effect. He has provided clear and underlying reasons against the monetary bonuses with data from meta-analysis conducted by Desi, Coinster, and Ryan that providing monetary bonuses can reduce the intrinsic motivation, especially if students initially had high interest in the task. Our reputed speaker clearly proved the argument stating that monetary bonuses is kind of control of selection rather than the support for students to cultivate life skills like dedication and accountability. She further substantiated the same with illustration from Finland, which is leading with the common sense practices and holistic teaching environment that strives for quality over bonuses with higher grades. Now, it's very clear that bonuses higher grades, which itself proves that bonuses for grades is nothing but a clear act of bribery. She concreted idea with UNESCO's 2020 Global Education Monitoring Report, which concludes that 258 million children are not in schools, and schools which introduces bonuses only for higher grades could bring in generation catastrophe, which undermine not only decades of progress, but also will deepen entrenched inequalities. Ladies and gentlemen, moreover, what extra proof required as the opening speaker put forward the views of top education experts like Andres S. against the monetary bonuses over economic and social benefits of learning. Over to you, moderator.
45 seconds for the judges to mark the ballot. Now, I would like to call the summary speaker from Team Affirmative, Toastmaster Amit Luthra.
cash incentives are spurs that goad a man to get something he does particularly want, says American statesman Paul G. Hoffman. A very good morning to debate moderator, respected judges, and my fellow Toastmasters. Schools should introduce monetary bonuses for students with highest grades. In support of this motion, our opening speaker presented the argument that monetary bonuses can keep kids and teens engaged with their studies while helping them to avoid the need to work and support them. It will also encourage them to continue performing well in studies. Then my fellow teammate presented a very motivating and encouraging statistic from a 2016 study where researchers found that monetary bonuses improved students' academic performance to the tune of 25 to 30%. He then enlightened us with a 2018 report of Center for International Studies Australia that shows steep jump in the ranking of schools due to introduction of monetary bonuses to students with highest grades. Then our rebuttal speaker very effectively demolished the opponent's argument regarding bonus as steroids or bribe with examples of study by Dr. Eric on how the monetary bonuses can motivate students and help them build their future. Renowned American economist Stephen Levitt once said, "Bonus is a bullet with astonishing power to change a situation." Friends, it's time for us to fire this bullet. So let's incentivize our education, motivate the highest graders with monetary bonuses, and keep them use those resources to shape their future. With this, gallant gladiators strongly support the motion that schools should introduce monetary bonuses for students with highest grades. Thank you all. Over to debate moderator.
3 minutes for the judges to mark the ballot. Zoom Master, please share the participation certificates. Zoom Master, could you please take a group picture of all the contestants?
Thank you.
With that, we come to the end of the seventh preliminary round debate between the Gallant Gladiators and the Killer Knights. Let us all give both the teams a big round of applause. The preliminary round of debates has come to an end. We have witnessed seven well-fought battles, and in a short while from now, we shall have the results. Thank you all for being such a wonderful audience. I now hand over the virtual podium to our charismatic MC, Toastmaster Jyoti.
Thank you, Toastmaster Khandijan. Wow, what an insightful sessions. There was so much to imbibe, really. Recapitulating my initial statements, I believe that inanimate objects always convey many things in a silent way. Well, here I have something very, very interesting to share. Please listen carefully. We all have to be careful because people are facing mental health issues from being isolated for so long. In fact, I have been discussing with the microwave and toaster during the coffee break today. And we all agreed that things are getting hot. I spoke with the window this morning because it was very open about it. I didn't mention anything to the washing machine as she puts a different spin on everything. Certainly not to the fridge as he has been acting very cold and distant. The toilet looked a bit flushed when I asked for his opinion. He didn't say anything, but the doorknob told me to get a grip. The front door said I was unhinged, and so the curtains told me to pull myself together. I tried to talk to the mirror as well, but it asked me to go reflect on myself first. The vacuum was very unsympathetic and told me to just suck it up. But the fan was more optimistic and hoped it would all soon blow over. In the end, the iron straightened me out. She said, everything will be fine and no situation is too pressing. Here we see how inanimate objects convey us pearls of wisdom in their mute and aristocratic fashion. Hope you all enjoyed this. Now comes the most awaited segment of the day, the award ceremony. I would like to invite the chief judge for the day, TTM Ramesh Antaraman, on the virtual stage. For those who don't know him, let me try to squeeze and share his elaborate portfolio in a nutshell. He has been in the Toastmaster fraternity for only 14 years and has worn different responsibility hats. We have seen him as area director, district finance manager, DTAC chair, and last but not the least, chairman of Dubai Speakers Bureau. Professionally, he's working in Fly Dubai as Senior Vice President of Revenue Management. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome the Chief Judge for the event, DTM Ramesh Antaraman. Over to you, sir. The virtual stage is yours.
Thank you very much, Jyoti. And I'd like to, before announcing the results, a few things. Number one, I'd like to thank the group of judges for the fantastic support over the last few days in preparing for this debate contest, as well as being here right from the beginning throughout the contest. Thank you very much. And for all my tally counters too. I'd like to thank again the coordinators who had made our job so very easy with the kind of immense support they offered us. And thank all the participants who were here early, as we would be wrapping up the meeting also quite early, and I'm requesting all the contestants, all the winners for tomorrow also to be early, that there is, it's quite possible that we will be running ahead of schedule tomorrow too. And I'm going to announce the results. We will have the winners of each of the seven debates. Apart from that, among the people who do not make it, who are not the winning team, the losing team with the highest average score would also go in for the finals tomorrow.
So without any further ado, let me announce the results. Debate number one, the winner is Little Lions. Drum rolls, please. And debate number two, the winner is Brilliant Brave Hearts. Debate number three, the winner is Articulate Avengers. Debate number four, the winner is Invincible Icons. Debate number five, the winner is Dynamic Daredevils. Debate number six, the winner is Heroic Hawks. Debate number seven, the winner is Killer Knights. And the eighth team, which is moving towards to the final tomorrow, is Gallant Gladiators. Thank you very much. Wishing all the teams fantastic event tomorrow, and all the participants, all the teams which participated today, thank you very much. Each and every one of you is a winner. And we had a fantastic debate. We had absolutely no kind of protests whatsoever. All the teams upheld the values of Toastmasters and did their best. Thank you very much. Back to you, MC. Toastmaster Jyoti.
Thank you, Chief Judge. All good things come to an end, and so has this debate today. Today there was thunder, surprise, excitement, shock, astonishment, disappointment, learning, unlearning, amazement, and contentment in the air. We all went through a medley of emotions, I believe. Here I recall a befitting quote. People will forget what you said. People will also forget what you did. But people will never forget how you made them feel. Today, we all must have felt the pulse of the crux of a debate that has left an invigorating taste. And I'm sure today's episode has etched in our memories for years to come. With this, I sign off for the day. But before leaving, I would a very, very important announcement for everyone. Please be with us tomorrow here to witness the finale. See you tomorrow. And thank you, everyone, lovely audience, for joining us and immortalizing this event. Have a great weekend ahead. See you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
See myself up on that list, but she said, where'd you wanna go? How much you wanna risk? I'm not looking for somebody with some superhuman gifts, some superhero, some fairy tale bliss, just something I can turn to, somebody I can kiss. I want something just like this. Blue.